Long days, pleasant nights, and welcome to Kingslingers, a Doof Media podcast journeying through Stephen King's Dark Tower series and beyond. I am your host, constant reader Scott Daly, and I'm joined, as always, by my good friend, everyone's favorite demon, the Monday Man himself. It's Matt Munchin Freeman. How's it going today, Matt?
Oh, it's going well, Scott. Looking forward to talking about this book with you today.
You know, if I had to pinpoint your accent, I would say it sounds like a French man trying to do a German accent.
Poor. No, I just have a cold.
Oh, okay.
Ironically, I actually do have a cold.
There's the joke. This week, on our penultimate episode covering Stephen King and Peter Straub's Black House, we are discussing chapters 22 through 25 of the novel as we wrap up part three. Jack flips back into our world and heads to see the dying mouse. Meanwhile, the fisherman has come for Henry Layton. Matt, what did you think of this week's reading?
Oh, it was great. It was very sad because of the loss of a character who very quickly became one of my favorite Stephen King characters, despite the fact that Henry Layton is not a central main character. You know, he's sort of you'd call him a secondary character, but he's an important character. I loved Henry Layton. I thought he was great. It's very sad to see him go, but it was executed so well that I wasn't like mad at the book. I was like, wow, what a powerfully executed moment. And it was so well integrated into the rest of the week's reading that this whole week's reading really elevated kind of the whole book for me, I think I can say. It's not like I didn't like the book before. I definitely did. But this is one moment where I was like, I see why people love this book, you know?
Yeah, no, I'm with you there, especially coming off of last week where, you know, again, it's not that we didn't like the chapter we ended last week on, but it's just it felt out of place is not the right word, but it wasn't our favorite part for sure. And coming from that into this week's reading, I re-fell in love with this book, and I think I agree with you that this is some of my favorite Stephen King writing in general. And again, we don't know how much Peter Straub had to do with any of this. I will say the Henry Layton action sequence, if we're going to call it that, feels very Stephen Kingy. So yeah. I don't know how much of that Peter Straub was involved in, but it felt like King doing the action tension thing the best that I think he's ever done it just about.
I agree. Well said.
All right, so let's get right into it and talk about it, because there's a lot. Oh my gosh, Matt, there's a lot to talk about here, because we go from action sequence to disgusting sequence, then to like this beautiful poetic writing that's trying to summarize the themes as we move into the third act of the book sequence. And there's just so much here.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So before we get into it, though, we do just have a quick announcement. The Doofcast, which took an unplanned 3-week hiatus this month, did not think it was going to happen, but it did, just due to timing and sickness and all that, is back this week. We'll be having a new episode. It'll be a canon episode, which is where we decide whether or not a movie is good enough to be entered into the Doof canon, which is, of course, is the greatest list of films that has ever been made ever, right?
That's right. What it is. That's, yeah. I mean, that's what we defined it to mean. So yeah
exactly. We will be talking about the film Idiocracy this week. Our patrons nominated and voted on this film for us to take a look at. So we'll be talking about that this Friday. So if you want to hear us again talk about a movie that you may or may not like, you can do that on Friday.
Yeah, a lot of people like that movie. So
yeah, I have not seen it in a long time. So I'm interested to see what my opinion of it is.
Interesting. I think I like that movie, but I agree that I haven't seen it in a really long time, so we'll
see. Yeah. All right, Matt, let's get right into chapter 22, the first of our four chapters this week. And this chapter picks up, you know, right where we left off last time. Jack was flipping back into our world, and that's where we meet him here. We do see, though, that his flipping has caused quite the stir here, Matt. Tables have been blown over. Alarms are sounding in the mental hospital. Guards are chasing mental patients all over the place. And Jack, of course, looks around at this chaos and responds to it by making out with a married woman.
And vice versa.
Yeah. They're getting down, man.
They really couldn't resist. I thought that was kind of a weird, funny moment, wasn't it?
It was a little bit,
Especially following after what happened in the last chapter, which is kind of like sweet and like pure and like And then it's like, he's groping her breast, and she likes it.
She's into it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, it was interesting. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. I'm curious what you think though about the amount of energy expelled with Jack's flip, right? I think some people describe it as an earthquake. Last week we noted how different this transition to the territories was for Jack than we have seen in the past, right? Normally he just flips over, not much happens. This time he brought stuff with him. He brought, you know, objects from the office and giant tools hiding in the closet. Now we see that it's released a lot of energy on his flip to the point that things are being blown over. Clothes have been blown off. Like the most similar transition here to one we've seen is when Morgan Sloat carved a hole to transfer over, you know. Uh-huh. It's really interesting. And the book doesn't really explain why exactly it happened this way.
Yeah. The only theory I had. So first worth pointing out that we've seen that Jack can step between territories easily and without causing any damage.
Yeah, he does it this week in his dreams, right? He just kind of slowly fades. Yeah.
Does it casually even as an adult. So the difference here is I think has to do with the fact that Judy is here. And and my feeling, which is not really too firmly supported, but my feeling that I walked away from this with is like by co-locating with Judy on Earth, he's kind of using her as a doorway to find Sophie, wherever she is physically. And maybe Sophie's like in Midworld instead of the territories or something, or like she's just much farther away in territories space or something. Regardless, it's different because he's seeking Sophie, not because he's just doing his normal step through the doorway to the other world thing.
Yeah, you're right, because there's no territories equivalent of the mental hospital they're in, right? I mean, I guess you could say the pavilion tent is a sort of hospital, so that's like a sort of equivalent, but it's not like we don't get this, like every time he flipped, at least in the talisman, there was, you know, territories equivalent of places, and it seems like he's not just flipped but traveled as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's the best explanation I have, I think it needed to also, just for the, you know, Doylistic sake of making it seem like an impactful moment, instead of just normal, you know, okay, he fades and now he's in the other world. It's like this is much more meaningful because this is him finding Sophie, his love, his like destined to be love. And that just feels more dramatic that way, honestly.
No, I think you're right there for sure. But Wendell is there as well. And Wendell, whose clothes have also been ripped to shreds by the force of flipping, looks out and sees Jack and Judy on the floor half naked and does what I think anyone would do. Immediately accuse Jack of rape.
Uh-huh.
So, Matt, remember when you said Wendell had like learned a lesson from his experience and he was heading down a path of redemption now? This was going to be a Wendell redemption arc. How you feeling about that now?
I guess I'm gonna have to walk back that guess. I really felt like that we were doing something with that character, but it sounds like, you know, I'm kind of mildly disappointed that, like, no, he's just a piece of shit. Like his visit to the territories appears to have resulted in zilch in terms of like consequences. Like he literally just denies that it even happened. I feel like Wendell is something. I thought maybe we were going to do something with pathos with Wendell, and it kind of seems more like we're going for like comic relief / he's just an asshole who's always going to be a thorn in the side of our hero.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. That's
yeah. You're not wrong. I think one thing that I do find interesting about the scene, and I think this echoes the conversations we've had before, once again, Wendell does catch Jack doing something he shouldn't be doing, right? He's got his hands on Judy's breast. Her skirt is up. The text says that you know, if they hadn't heard a large crash just outside the office, things could have gone much further there, right? And Judy is like technically a mental patient suffering from a psychotic break, right? So there's a world that exists where someone observes the scene and does indeed come to the conclusion that Wendell comes to legitimately, that this person is a mental patient who has a psychotic break. She is not able to consent to the level that we would want, right? we of course know this isn't true, right? We have knowledge of Judy and who she is and how she's doing, but Wendell doesn't, not necessarily. So once again, he catches Jack doing something that you could argue, Jack, you probably shouldn't be doing this. But then the text like takes this complication and then kind of just doesn't mince words with it at all, because it makes it very clear that Wendell is just not reading the situation incorrectly or coming to a conclusion that anyone would, but he's actively distorting things for his own purposes, right? The text here says his mind is whirling and filled with impossible memories. His balance is shot. His stomach is chugging like a washing machine that has been overloaded with clothes and suds. He desperately needs something to hold on to. He needs news. Even better, he needs scandal. And here lying in front of him on the floor are both. You know, we go through this complication where again and again and again, when Wendell has come into Jack's life, it's been to point out something that is questionable. But then we kind of take away the nuance here. I don't know. What do you feel about that?
Yeah, I totally agree that there's something interesting going on. Like, yeah, he's seeing Jack do things that don't make a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. But he always reacts in like the least helpful way. Yeah. He's always a huge asshole about it. And then he usually ends up getting concussed or beaten in some way, mm-hmm. which at this point has become kind of a running gag.
It's
like you're third, right, or fourth time this has happened.
Yeah, Jack just punches him in the head. And then the text makes a comment like, oh, this has been a bad week for Wendell's brains, which is true.
Right, right. Well, that's the thing is, like, in that moment, that just felt like a again, a running gag. It's a joke. And maybe that's all we're doing. Like, maybe it's just like, Wendell Green is a joke. And this is mm-hmm. kind of not the kind of thing that we've seen before in a Stephen King novel that I can remember, where it's just like a character whose purpose is to be a joke, like a punchline. But maybe that's literally all we're doing with Wendell Green. Maybe my mistake was thinking like, well, clearly we're setting something up with this character. And it's like, mm-hmm. yeah, what we're setting up is it's funny to watch him get punched.
I mean, I do think there's a little more going on there, but we should, you know, finish the book before we fully have that conversation.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I always have this, I feel like we've had several King books where I've brought up Gollum as like a concept where it's like, you've got this character who's bad, but you can't really say what the point of Gollum was in the story until the end.
Right.
And that's I feel that way about Wendell. Like, we can't really say what the point of Wendell is until we see how he ends up.
I mean, I get what you said. I think even before the very end of Lord of the Rings, you can very clearly see the foil for Frodo that Gollum is representing there. So like, while you haven't seen the full scope of that, you can kind of see the outline of it. And I don't know, perhaps you mm-hmm. could see the outline of Wendell's purpose in this story at this point, but I'm not 100% sure. I'm not comfortable enough that you can see that outline that I want to fill it in for you quite yet, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I agree with everything you just said. We'll see what happens.
Yeah. Before he gets out of Dodge, Jack grabs the tape that the fisherman left for Judy, intent on bringing it to Henry to listen to. But then he says this: but the fisherman's identity no longer matters much, and Speedy knew it. Neither does his location, because Jack has an idea Chummy Burnside can flip to a new one pretty much at will. Oh, okay. So I guess none of that matters anymore.
Yep, none of that matters. Yeah, it's funny because we largely knew this, but maybe as the reader, we hadn't thought through the implications. And uh-huh. by that, I mean, like, there was never any way that the cops were going to be able to arrest somebody who can flip.
Yeah.
The way Bernie flips. Like, in fact, he already escaped from the cops once, you know, in his previous life. Mm-hmm. So we know he could do it again. So it was always going to have to be Jack doing territory shit to stop the fisherman. We knew that, even if we hadn't like thought it through. But now the story, I think, has added the wrinkle that it's not just that you have to stop Bernie. You have to do some complicated metaphysical thing involving Black House and Munchen and confronting this much greater evil. That's what has to be sorted out. And it kind of takes all of the stakes, all of the sort of mundane stakes, and says like, yeah, these don't matter anymore.
Yes. And the most interesting thing about it, and I think the thing you and I are probably going to spend the most time talking about this week, is that while the book very clearly draws things to make it clear that those stakes don't matter, they still run their course. And the big thing I'm thinking of here is the entire Henry Layton death scene and what he's and quote unquote the reason why Bernie is there in Henry's home in the first place. And we'll get to this, but it's just food for thought as we kind of prep that conversation. Is we've said that all these detective story mystery things are no longer relevant to the plot. We've said it right here. Like, right, it's black and white here. The fisherman's identity no longer matters, nor does his location. And yet we continue to roll with those plot beats anyway, which is very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, this whole week's reading is like two heavy costs that we're paying for what? Nothing. Henry Layton and Mouse. And like, what do we gain from that? Mm-hmm. We gain one magic word of ambiguous value. And I don't even know if we gain anything from Henry, except maybe a kind of spiritual reminder, which we'll get to when we get to that moment, I think.
Yeah.
But I think works. I'm not complaining, by the way. I'm not saying like this doesn't work.
Like, no, I mean, we said at the intro that these chapters are like our favorite in the book and we're like completely in love with this book. I find it very fascinating the way the beat to beat plot stuff is rolling out in the story.
Yeah. I mean, if anything, what's surprising to me is that you can just, you know, rug pull what you thought the stakes of the story were. And you as the reader are like, oh, I don't really care. It's fine.
Yeah, I mean, this is a complete tangent, but I've been thinking a lot about the Obi-Wan Kenobi show, which in its final episode, like, just did not have any stakes that mattered at all. And like, I have a lot of opinions and tune into the Doofcast to hear us talk about this further. But I have a lot of opinions on how and where are the correct ways and the good ways to set up believable stakes that work. And I think the most fascinating thing about this story is it kind of proves that if you pull off other things, that shit doesn't matter anymore. You can just pick all that up and toss it in the garbage and your readers are not going to care because they've latched onto something else, which is the relationship between Henry and Jack and why all these things matter on a personal character level.
Right. Yep.
All right. So Jack sees our friendly neighborhood guard, Ethan Evans, physically abusing a patient. So he punches him in the head too. This is just what we're doing now, Matt. We're just punching people right in the head all the time.
It's cool.
Then we cut over to Wendell encountering Ethan, and they decide to start the gotten their asses handed to us by Jack Sawyer Club. We leave Ethan, thanks to Wendell's influence, absolutely convinced of Jack Sawyer's like essential evil, right? Wendell basically tells Ethan, oh, he raped a patient. And Ethan, of course, believes this right away. The way we leave this random character is he's going to promise to tell one person that would love to hear about how bad Jack Sawyer is. So I'm curious, like, what your take on this whole thing is.
Well, it seems like we're building toward a situation where Jack's reputation with the authorities is ruined, and he comes off looking like some combination of crazy and a loose cannon and ethically compromised regarding the case. A lot of it makes it difficult for the good guys to do their jobs, which is more dramatic. And then it also kind of makes me lean toward Jack is not going to be retiring on Earth when this is all over. he's going to end up in the territories or die. And I'm not sure. And I don't know. I do feel like I'm missing something. I feel like there's the outline of a thematic crux that we're heading toward that I'm like not able to articulate because I feel like I'm missing a couple puzzle pieces. But
okay.
It feels like the kind of thing where when it becomes clear, I'll be like, I should have been able to figure that out, but I just can't see it right now.
Well, I guess the question I want to ask you, like, Ethan gestures towards some vague person that he's going to tell.
I think that's going to be the wife of the guy of the previous serial killer.
Okay.
That's what I assumed.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Well, we'll find out.
Yeah.
So Jack gets back to his car and starts heading to Beezer's to see the not in good shape Mouse. But first he stops by at his old friend Henry's to chat. And we see, you know, the reason he's doing this is because he's worried about Henry. I love this quote here. Abela, Jack mutters, Abela Dune and Mr. Munchin and the Crow Gorg, just three old pals walking together on Night's Plutonian shore. For some reason, this makes him think of the walrus and the carpenter from Alice. What was it that they took for a walk in the moonlight? Clams? Mussels? Jack's damned if he can't remember, although one line surfaces and resonates in his mind, spoken in his mother's voice. The time has come, the walrus said, to talk of many things. I'm just curious what you what your takeaway was from the introduction of this walrus and the carpenter poem, I guess, story in at this point in this story.
I don't remember what the walrus and the carpenter means at this exact moment. Basically, it's about two guys who are like eating all of these clams or whatever while one of them is excusing it and the other one is telling a story about how he regrets having to do it, but he's still doing it, which kind of reminds you of what like it kind of reminds you a little bit of like Bernie and Munchin as being two different entities who maybe have slightly different attitudes about what they're doing, but not a lot because they both seem to kind of really enjoy the whole murdering kids thing. So I don't know who else would be like a better analog. I don't know. I'm missing something. You're throwing me these softballs and I'm just like whiffing one after another.
I mean, there's no wrong answer here. I like what you said. I like the Bernie Munt. I think the thing, you know, we've talked about the way Stephen King uses literary references, right? And he uses it in a way that it doesn't matter if you don't know anything about The Walrus and the Carpenter as a poem. But, you know, if you've never read the Lewis Carroll poem or it's been so long since you read it that you have not taken any thematic resonance away from that, there might be some more richness you can mine from it. But I think functionally, the part of this whole thing that matters is Jack's damned if he can remember, although one line surfaces and resonates in his mind, spoken in his mother's voice. The time has come to talk of many things. And I do think that's we're in this moment, you know, where at some point in this chapter, Jack's going to be like, I have to tell Henry what's going on. And I should have told him from the beginning. And of course, he doesn't get the opportunity to do that because Henry is taken from him. And then our reading this week ends with Jack telling Dale everything. Right. This idea that this is kind of the time for us to cut the shit and start communicating with people and being honest. And of course, I think it is very important that this comes from Jack's mother. Once again, like this is the thing that I have noticed this read more than anything. Jack's mom is omnipresent in this book, and it's not in a way that's direct. It's not like Jack doesn't literally think about his mom that often. There are beats and moments throughout the thing, but she's always there. She's always there in some way, shape, or form. She's always a part of whatever's happening to him, and I think it's really interesting.
Yeah, we can see the rawness of his grief kind of between the lines. It's not something that he looks at directly. And just on your note that like now is the time to share, except it's sort of too late almost because he loses Henry, and I was only half joking last week when I was like, you know, we talked about the pros and cons of it, but when I was saying like he could have at least said to the Thunder Five, like, hey, what you're going to face is pure evil and supernatural. And they might have scoffed. It might have been a difficult conversation, but it's like, okay, well, you didn't have the difficult conversation and now one of them is dead. And they might effectively be completely broken as like an effective unit to help you. So like that's the kind of thing where it's like, yeah, Jack, maybe you needed to have these conversations earlier and you're being punished for not having done so even.
Yeah, no, I like that. I mean, this whole idea that like this whole book has been Jack running from the truth of the matter. And I think part of that running, it has been his willingness to share that with the people most important to him.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, like he's come to accept the territory and remember the territories again and remember his adventures and remember what all these things meant, but he hasn't shared that with the people around him yet. And yeah, I mean, I think you're right that is like, who knows how different things would have played out if he did go to Henry from the beginning and say, look, you're going to think I'm crazy, but here's all this shit.
Yeah.
I mean, he says on his way to tell Henry later in the chapter that, oh no, Henry's going to look at this and be like blown away. And like, of course he's going to believe me and accept it. Like it's going to be marvelous. It's going to be wonderful. We're jumping all over the place this week, but yeah. I think it's just important that these things are being laid here, I believe.
Well, yeah, I think you're right. And also it's kind of funny. I didn't think of this last week, but like, you know, in our there's a vampire on my house hypothetical, you have no evidence by design. That's part of the hypothetical. Mm-hmm. Whereas Jack can just be like, I'm going to disappear right in front of your eyes right now.
That's true. That's true.
So,
although I wonder if he would be able to do that, you know, like probably, but
I mean, the book doesn't say he can't. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah. I just feel like that removes some of the magic of of the territories. If he's just like, here, let me prove it real quick.
It would. And that really doesn't seem like a Stephen King sort of thing to do, you know, yeah. But I don't know. It just.
Sure.
Proving that it's real should not be that big of an obstacle, actually.
No, I think you're right. Yeah. Unfortunately, Matt, Henry isn't home. He's out, you know, trying to get a job with ESPN. So Jack leaves his old friend the new Fisherman tape, which we've been told already doesn't matter at all. And then he heads over to Beezer's.
Yeah. 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 But more, you know, more Jack already knew this, but, yeah. You know, whatever. Now this character we like will nobly sacrifice their life to tell Jack this stuff he already knows.
Yeah. Speaking of which, along the way, Jack notices that he can kind of tell where Black House is by feeling, kind of similar to the way when he was over in the territories, he could just feel the general location of the rot that was going on over there, which has this interesting effect of making our hero think that he might not actually need the information that Mouse is desperately clinging to life to deliver to him. I think the truth of that is actually a bit more complicated. I think, you know, the magic word that Mouse gives him seems to indicate that that conversation did matter and Mouse's sacrifice did matter. But it is interesting that we're framing this, you know, specifically as, oh, I don't actually need this information. I mean, the first thing Jack says when he sees the look on Beezer's face when he opens the door is like, oh, I could never possibly tell this guy that I don't actually need anything that he and Mouse have to give me. Their whole sacrifice was for nothing because I know exactly where the house is.
Yeah. And plus, as you said a second ago, like the magic spell that he's able to obtain might be something that's so valuable that he doesn't even realize that that's what he needs. But
right.
He does get that out of this, which the magic spell, I guess we'll talk about that when we get there, but
it
was a more overt sort of intrusion of, you know, the white into the narrative than we normally see.
No, that's certainly true. Certainly true. So as the chapter ends, we learn here, Matt, that Doc and Beezer and the Dying Mouse are the only members of the Thunder Five left. We learn that Kaiser Bill and Sonny got scared and just ran off. So to answer your question from last week, you will never get the backstory of Kaiser. You'll never know.
Yeah.
Because he's just gone.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? Like, mm-hmm. I guess it's fair to say that the Thunder Five quartet is broken. We've got one dead member. We've got two that just left.
Yep.
You know, which I somewhat surprised to see, I guess. I kind of thought we were like going to get a round two, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think just for the record's sake, you're 0-2 on your predictions from last week because
I honestly we all everyone laugh at Matt, yes, but I feel like I am like not necessarily getting what this book is doing as much as I feel like I usually am, and that doesn't have any impact on my level of enjoyment, but like I think I had a much cleaner and clearer idea of the themes of the talisman than I do of this book.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is another, and I think we've talked about this before in some other Stephen King books. Like there are books like The Talisman that I think are very at home in traditional storytelling techniques, right? Uh-huh. That is, you know, we talked about it, an Odyssean type adventure story. The same with a book like The Eyes of the Dragon, right? These are very traditional. They're playing in the tradition of grand storytelling, and so it's pretty easy to like get your head around what the book is doing. You kind of, if you have any experience looking at stories at all, instantly get that.
Yeah.
You're right that Black House is a much more complicated book in that regard. It is not playing in a lot of these standard storytelling tropes. It is much, much different than The Talisman in this regard. And so it's very difficult to try to kind of get to the bottom of what's going on here.
Especially because it makes you think it's going to be a detective story. And then it at this point seems to have just totally dumped all that.
Yeah, yeah, definitely true. So what I'm saying is I don't think you should feel bad about not necessarily being on the same wavelength as a book as far as, you know, exactly what it's doing. I think when we talk, when the book is over, we'll probably have a lot to say about, you know, looking at it holistically, what we think this book is doing.
Well, I will accept your softening of the blow for now. It will be cool to look back on this, though. I feel like this is one that I'll need to process afterward.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right. So we move on to chapter 23. And before we get back with poor Mouse, we've got Henry to hang out with for a bit. And I think, you know, we talked about this in the intro, but these next few chapters, and this one especially, is probably my absolute favorite thing in this entire book, despite the horrible tragedy contained within them. Just like in this chapter alone, the way King and Straub write this kind of building of tension, cross-cutting between Henry's just like normal day leading up to his fight with the fisherman and Jack's horror show with Mouse and what's going on with him. I just think it's like the perfect way to mine tension out of these two scenes and use them to enhance each other. Like they build off each other in such a perfect way. The times and the places that we choose to cut, it doesn't feel like, oh, I'm being taken away from the action that I want to be there. It just feels like, oh, we can use this to build the tension, and we there's some tension building in the Henry stuff, and then we cut over to Mouse and oh my god, the horror there, which also stresses us out, which builds tension. So when we cut back to Henry, we're feeling even more stressed and we don't necessarily even know why yet. I think it's just brilliant, just absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, that's a great point. You know, it seems to be so hard to do a proper, you know, dramatic intercut between two scenes that very often I'm like, why do people even try to do this? But this is an example where it's like, oh, this is why, because it, like you just said, it actually amplifies what's able to be achieved with both of the threads by threading them together like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's great. I agree with you. I love this chapter. Yeah.
So we learn that Henry isn't home because he's out taking a meeting with an ESPN guy who wants to take the George Rathbun show national. I love this little, I guess we could call it like a digression vignette here a bit, where this ESPN guy is just like a total creep that Henry has to tell the fuck off. And then Nick Avery, the bartender at the hotel bar, is like kind of completely enamored with Henry Layton and sticks up for our favorite blind guy. It's just really like, it doesn't matter to the way the rest of the chapter plays out, but I really, really like it.
Yeah, it's a really beautiful, cool interaction, which I think also serves the added important function of reminding us how much we like Henry. Mm-hmm. And how remarkable he is, like showing us Henry being a cool badass, just like likable dude who's awesome before he then embarks upon this, you know, terrible ordeal is actually a good way of grounding us.
Yeah, you're exactly right there, because I think it is important that and I think what King and Straub would say they're trying to do here is, as we move into Henry's death, we reestablish that this man is special. He is and the special in the way that, and not in the same way, but in a similar way to the way Jack Sawyer is special, in that people see him and are just kind of taken by him. And so there's this random bartender that probably sees hundreds of drunk idiots a day, like sees and recognizes the quality of Henry Layton immediately.
Yeah, he is cool, as we defined cool in our previous discussion question.
Exactly. But of course, something else is happening during this meeting, Matt. Our Henry is once again getting whiffs of his dead wife's perfume titled My Sin, which is perfect.
Uh-huh.
We also see here that Henry calls his wife Lark, and that word comes to him right now in this part.
Yeah, which, you know, is a type of bird. And I think it's been a while since we talked about this, but we did note at one point that both the talisman and this book have an unusual amount of bird imagery.
Yeah, and you're right. Here's another one.
Yeah.
And we have a lot to say more about this, the perfume smell and the feeling, like he also gets, he feels touched on the back of his neck in this moment. But I love this part here. Say that she has come back. Say that she has. If it's love she's come with, why does the smell of her perfume make me so uneasy, so almost revolted? And why was her touch, her imagined touch, he assures himself, so unpleasant? Why was her touch so cold? And this is, again, the point where Stephen and Peter choose to cut away from Henry and go back with Henry or Jack and Mouse, which is just perfect because it just leads you with just enough dread as you move into the next scene.
Right. Yeah, exactly. And it allows us to kind of move through time as well. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So back with Jack as he enters Beezer's, we learn that Mouse is considerably worse than when we last saw him, Matt. Light now causes his skin to melt, and he smells horribly of spoiled meat. The evil of the Black House here is quite literally rotting away his insides. I like this quote right here. Mouse seemed to gather himself. Beneath the blanket, his body shivers in a loose, uncoordinated way that Jack guesses is next door to a seizure. Somewhere, a clock is ticking. Somewhere, a dog is barking. A boat hoots on the Mississippi. Other than that, the sound, all is silent. Jack can remember only one other such suspension of the world's business in his entire life, and that was when he was in a Beverly Hills hospital waiting for his mother to finish the long business of dying.
Yeah, there's that mention of his mother again at this.
Omnipresent, right? Yep.
And just on a plot level, I'm actually surprised that Mouse died. Like, I kind of figured that Jack would like get there and bring some of his like Jesus healing powers that I guess mistakenly assumed that he must have somewhere.
I mean, he definitely does a little bit of that, but not enough. Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. He's able to do one small thing, which I guess earns us a little bit of a boon.
Mm-hmm. So at first, Mouse is just kind of talking nonsense here. He's talking about the details of brewing beer. But in between all this nonsense, he does say something that are important to the other scene running in this chapter. The perfume he smells is not that of his dead wife. He's caught in the eye of the king. Gorg ten abla, ili li, the Opopanax is dead. Long live the Opopanax. Another you know, example of how the cross cutting really works here, because we're building tension in the other scene with a fact in this scene, and we can layer them on top of each other in really fun ways like this.
Yeah, that's a great point. Because we have this supernatural, you know, ambiguously supernatural element, it's like, yeah, that makes sense. Sure. Mm-hmm. We'll allow that.
To illustrate just how bad things are, Doc pulls the blankets covering Mouse back, and we don't get to see what this looks like yet, Matt. Straub and King use this as a transition moment to transition over to Henry to bait us and make us wait, but all we see here is that it causes Jack to scream, so we just get to live with how horrible this might be for a few pages.
I kind of say I like that. We've talked about this before and how much more effective it can be to not show something. And I definitely... You know, when they describe it, it's horrible, but not describing it left me to imagine something, you know, worse than you could possibly describe.
Sure. So we're back now with Henry as he arrives home to his empty house, still smelling his wife's perfume, still feeling a presence here and an amorous sigh, he says. So I want to talk to you about this a bit, Matt, because we do know later that the fisherman has gone into his bathroom and doused himself in Rhoda's perfume. So some of the smell that we're smelling, at least in this moment, is the fisherman himself. But the smells in other places, the sighs, the feelings, and the ghostly touches and presences, that's not all Bernie, right? That's actually something supernatural.
That's something else. And I don't know. I mean, it's fun. It's fun that it's not nailed down. I think I had this feeling that it's kind of like Mouse said, that he's sensing the malign attention of the eye of the Crimson King.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe that manifests as him sensing a presence, or him sensing specifically the presence of his wife, or maybe the Crimson King is manifesting the ghost of his wife to freak him out, because the Crimson King does shit like that. I mean, this isn't something that we've talked about much, but there have been times throughout these books that we've been studying where King seems to envision the Crimson King as being kind of a Sauron like figure who can kind of see things that are far away, maybe project himself or manifestation of himself and his attention to distant places, like specifically when he confronts Ralph Roberts is what I'm thinking of mainly. It's like that, you know, that's just pure psychic shit. And so why not just think maybe it's the Crimson King? But, you know, it could also be his wife's ghost, right? It could just be his shining acting up and giving him a sense of dread about the danger that he's in. You know, it could be any number of things. And I don't particularly care which one it is. I think it's really effectively creepy regardless.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I have to believe this has nothing to do with his wife at all, because there's too much evil and malignant stuff going on here. Yeah. That it would just make me sad if his wife was at all involved in any of this. I think you're right. Like, I think this is, you might, as we go through this process, start to understand why so many people were so disappointed by who the Crimson King ended up being in book 7, right? Uh-huh. We have all these novels in which he's this, I think a Sauron like presence is a perfect explanation of he's kind of this all powerful and not ever seen physically, but felt over and over again throughout these stories. And I continue to say, despite all this information, that the truth of the Crimson King in that final book works wonderfully on me, both thematically and just plot wise. I love that curveball. It's delightful. But I do understand, you know, when we see stuff like this, why people had so much disappointment. So yeah, I think it's just the Crimson King is fucking with him and using his grief and using his sorrow. And that's a word, sorrow, that we're going to be talking about a lot this week, to kind of just fuck him up a little bit. Yeah. Make him uncomfortable, mess with him.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Yep.
So I just love the way this whole section is written, though. We're in Henry's point of view, which means our sight of the room is rather limited, and it kind of allows us to feel more than I think we normally would have the kind of the quiet loneliness of Henry Layton and his life right now as he kind of just goes through his afternoon. This, again, I know I said a lot, but this helps build the tension of these scenes. We're not sure exactly what's going to happen here, right? We know something's going to happen. The book is gesturing towards something not good happening, but we don't necessarily know what it is yet. And so we just get this feeling. And I think there's no description. There's not very many description of like the way things look or the way the house, like it's all told from a really close point of view of Henry. So it's just how he experiences the world.
Yeah. I love it. Really like just high skill writing where you don't necessarily even consciously realize that things are being described in a way that doesn't involve visual cues, but you still end up with a very full sense of the way everything is. It's great.
So Henry tries to call Jack here, but the latter has left his goddamn phone in the car, which is just like a Jack thing that he keeps fucking not having his phone on him. This is some 2001 bullshit, Matt. Nobody would not have their phone on them now.
It's funny. Like I kind of want to just brush that off, but like Jack Sawyer does seem like the kind of guy who would like disdain that he like technology, you know, given the themes of the talisman, you can imagine him being like, all right, fine, I'll have a cell phone, but I don't like it. And I don't, you know, I don't know. Makes sense to me.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I think this is actually, I don't think Stephen King likes cell phones very much because I'm reading the Bill Hodges trilogy right now. I just finished the second book in it. And that's a character who throughout both of the first two books is like consistently forgetting his cell phone places and then being like, god damn it. Now the plot events, because I left my cell phone somewhere, fucking cell phones. I just don't think Stephen King likes cell phones very much, or at least he didn't at this point.
I can imagine him specifically not liking them because they're basically just a pure source of distraction and interruption.
Yeah.
And his whole life seems to be built around like carefully cultivating his writing time and his attention. So
yeah, I mean, what I'm not saying here is that he also wrote an entire book in which cell phones turn people into literal zombies. So
what book is that? I don't even know.
It's a book called Cell.
Oh, okay.
All it's right. Not the best, but
okay.
It's a Stephen King attempt on a zombie story. And there's parts of it that are really interesting. The movie adaptation is just awful. We'll have to do another Levels of the Tower on that someday.
Oh, that sounds fun. Let's do that next.
Okay. All right, so we go back with Jack now, and we get to see the description of the thing that we cut away from last time. And you're right that I think your brain could maybe make something up more disgusting, but I think the words do some pretty good work here, Matt, because this is what things look like. There's still the shape of a leg there, Sort of. But the flesh has spread away from the bone. The skin is almost completely gone, melted to a runny substance that looks like a mixture of milk and bacon fat. The interwoven mat of muscle beneath what remains of the skin is sagging and undergoing some cataclysmic metamorphosis. The infected leg is in a kind of undisciplined motion as the solid becomes liquid and the liquid sizzles relentlessly into the couch upon which Mouse is lying. Along with the almost insupportable stench of decay, Zach can smell scorching cloth and melting fabric. That's gross.
Yeah. The Black House security system is not fucking around.
No, it is not.
But yeah, no, it's you know, he's melting. Slowly and painfully melting and rotting and losing his mind, and it's horrifying.
I didn't pull it out, but I do like the detail of the part where his foot is just completely fine. Like, this is his leg, but his foot below it is just completely normal looking.
Yeah.
To the point where Jack's like, I could just pick it up and just take and just pop it off right now.
Yeah. Just,
Which I don't know if that's an intentional callback to the fisherman's propensity to just lob feet off, but it certainly relates to it. It's a similar image.
Yeah. That seems intentional, although not necessarily overt. The connection didn't occur to me until you said that. And then I was like, yeah, that seems reasonable. Sure.
So I really like this bit about how Mouse is the only one that can even remember where Black House is, right? We see here that both Doc and Beezer, despite just being there just now, have forgotten already where it is. But whatever demon thing is infecting Mouse is also seemingly allowing him to not forget this experience.
Yeah, it seems like you know, the only thing they gained in that whole adventure to Black House was that Mouse at least got close enough that he made some kind of meaningful psychic contact with the greater powers involved in the situation.
Yeah, which is interesting. I mean, we're going to talk about Jamba, the magic word, here in a bit. But one of the things we're told is the reason Mouse even heard this word in the first place is while he was at Black House, right? That the experience of getting close to touching this great evil is what gave him his brain access to this incredibly powerful spell, which is interesting, right?
Yeah. Don't really know what to make of it, but yeah, it definitely is. The whole idea of the spell, we'll talk about that in a minute, but that by itself is a fascinating little twist to me.
Mm-hmm. So back with Henry, he dreams about walking down the path towards the Black House, something we know he'll never actually get to do. He wakes up from this dream and finds that a book and the can of beer he knows for a fact that he left in his lap have been carefully placed on the side table. So did Mr. Fisherman do this? Did he come over there and say, oh, you're going to spill that? Here, let me just put this over here for you.
I mean, yes. I like, okay, so at that point in the reading, I didn't guess that Burnside was physically in his house.
Sure.
So it didn't occur to me as a possibility. But I don't have any other guesses. Like, what else would it be? You know, like, it could have been Burnside, and maybe he just enjoys toying with people. I don't know. It is interesting. Like, it's a minor thing, but it didn't bother me at all, honestly, until you asked the question. And I'm like, it must have been, right? I mean, what the hell could it have been?
Yeah, I mean, I think in the moment, you're absolutely right that this is meant to once again like reinforce the idea that there's a ghostly presence here, kind of floating around and cleaning up after Henry. But yeah, I mean, it's not clear how much of this whole experience is it just in his brain, how much of it is the literal fisherman physically being in his house doing things, and how much of it is, you know, just the influence of the Crimson King just fucking with him.
Yeah. Yeah. All the above.
You can't just say that. It can't just be all of them.
Well, it's kind of fun that it's left ambiguous. Like, this is the kind of thing that makes me think that it's Stephen King, by the way, because he loves to be ambiguous and just let you think, like, whatever, like, there's no answer. You don't know. It's unknowable. It's undefined. That's what makes it kind of creepy.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. So Doc gives Mouse some speed, which energizes him just enough to regain some semblance of consciousness. Mouse begins drawing a map for Jack and the rest of them to show them how to get back to Black House. But the black goop from Prometheus doesn't like this and tries to take Mouse down. But Magic Jack uses some of those healing powers you said he had, and he just yanks some of that black goop off of him, yanks it out of his eye, throws it down on the ground where Beezer steps on it, killing it. And thus Venom is dead.
Yeah, I was going to say, we haven't seen the last of that. Whenever somebody throws black goop on the ground, you just have to, you just know that's going to, there's going to be a sequel involved.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
Yeah. No. Oh my God. There's going to be a sequel, isn't there? No, but that was just pretty cool. It's a pretty cool moment.
It was. And it's again, a pretty cool moment predicated on the fact that we're all with Jack kind of being like, oh good, a map, I'm definitely gonna need that, Mouse, thanks buddy. Where's the Black House? I don't know.
Oh,
I couldn't find it without your help.
Please use your last breath to tell me this piece of information. Thanks.
So Henry, meanwhile, has begun to work on listening to the tapes of the fisherman. He will eventually be able to pinpoint Charles Burnside, the man at Maxton's that was rude to him while he was DJing. But as we've said, Matt, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And that's the odd thing about this actually wonderful scene. Even the final message that Henry is able to leave Jack as he dies doesn't matter, really. He doesn't give him any information that he didn't already know, or does he? And I mean, we'll talk about this. We'll talk about this when the time comes. But again, just to reiterate, it's so strange that none of this work matters. This is the final thing Henry's going to do before he gets attacked and die. Right. And it just doesn't matter.
Yeah, I think the way I see it is, it doesn't matter in terms of the police procedural story that we thought we were reading. Mm-hmm. But it matters in terms of the emotional story about a boy and his mother.
Yes. Yeah. No, you're 100% right. Yeah. And then there's this wonderful part. In that moment of hesitation, he is positive he isn't alone, and that someone or something is standing just outside the studio door, looking in at him through the glass upper half. And that is, in fact, the absolute truth. Blessed with sight as we are, we can see what Henry cannot. We want to tell him what is out there, to lock the studio door. For the love of God, lock it now. But we can only watch. And so this is when you realize, Matt, that the fisherman is there, standing there watching him, and has been for who knows how long.
Yeah. It's interesting to me how our floating point of view is being invoked here, because this is the only instance I can think of where, you know, dang, if only we could do something is being put to us, right?
Yeah.
Like normally it's just like, yeah, we're just the floating point of view. Not even a suggestion that we could do something. Like, and this isn't saying that we could do something. It's saying, we wish we could do something.
Yeah. It reinforces something we've talked about a few times in this book is just how active the point of view is in the story, and how often we physically fill the space, even though we are still powerless to do anything to change the story.
Yeah. Like, don't you get a strong sense that the camera is inside the room with Henry and we're looking at the door from inside, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and I feel confident that most people reading got that impression. Right. And
yeah,
it's because we're being painted as being an object in the scene.
Yeah. Yeah. No, yeah. Totally. And once again, we've talked about Stephen King and cinema so much, but like, I can totally see exactly how this scene would be shot.
Yeah. Me too.
To maximize that reveal.
Yep.
So yes, the person watching is the fisherman, of course, and the interesting thing to note here is that he's basically seeing Henry both play and expertly impersonate his voice, and that is very upsetting to old Bernie, right? The reason he chooses to knock on the door at this moment is because he is getting increasingly agitated by Henry's spot-on impression of him.
Yeah, I wonder why he finds it so upsetting. I didn't really understand that, actually.
Let's put a pin in that, because I want to talk about that when we get to the final chapter and we kind of spend some time with Charles Burnside's. Because I think there is a reason, and I think the book gestures towards it, not explicitly, but we'll talk about it.
Yeah, okay.
But before we deal with the fisherman knocking at Henry's door, we cut back over to Jack as Mouse gives his final wishes and gives one last warning to Jack. Don't go in the Black House tonight. Wait until tomorrow. Ty will be safe until tomorrow. Mouse knows this, of course, because Speedy Parker told him, because Speedy's just fucking just talking to everyone.
Yeah, sure. He can do that. I believe it.
Yeah, yeah. He can do whatever he wants. He's Parkus. He's a gunslinger, but not.
Uh-huh.
He also gives Jack a powerful word, a spell, Diamba. And then Mouse dies, and our chapter ends here.
When he died, I kind of imagined it being like the Senator character in the first X-Men movie.
Oh. You mean when he just turns to liquid and just wastes away?
Just like sloughs off the table into fluid, yeah.
I don't think that's quite how it goes down, but sure, sure.
I mean, that's what I saw in my mind. So, okay, so let's talk about Diamba for a second.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess we're going to talk more about Diamba because that's how the next chapter begins. But isn't the very idea of a spell is, as far as I remember, totally novel here? Like, I don't remember any other spells ever being really talked about or used.
No, I mean, even in the instance of like a literal wizard or sorcerer or whatever you want to call the Man in Black, he barely talks about spells themselves. Like he does magic, certainly, but like it's not spells in the traditional sense of that word.
Yeah. A lot of what he did was just like exploiting the unique properties of materials. not saying words of power is not something that he ever did that I can recall.
I mean, I guess you could argue that his resurrection of the weed eater in Tull, it was a spell in that he was performing an act, like the jack hammering over the body, but still not in the way of like, here's a word of power type thing.
Yeah, right, exactly.
This is so Stephen King. This is why I love Stephen King's world building, because he just does whatever the fuck he wants. It's like, what do we need? I don't know, man. Like, this is going to be a spell. It's just a word. It's a power word. Yeah. And where does it come from? I don't know. Why is it Diamba? I don't know, man. It's just a word.
It's cool. Shut up.
Shut up. It's cool. Yeah. I mean, that's some people. I completely understand why some people would get frustrated by this and like say like there's no rules to this world, there's no consistency, and I'm like, yeah man, that's why it's great, because it's just there and it doesn't actually matter, because we don't care about the origin of Diamba. We care about, you know, what this means for our characters.
Right. Yes. If you get bogged down in rules and consistency, then you know
you're not gonna have a good time with this guy, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So chapter 24 ends with this long paragraph, and I'm not going to read it all because it's very long, but it's kind of like a little bit of an explanation, the most explanation we get of what Diamba is, right? It says a bright and powerful spell, powerful connections form a web that extends, ramifying through infinity. So it just kind of shoots through all of our characters from Jack all the way to Henry, also touching Charlie Burnside as well, and Mr. Munchen, who hate it immediately.
Yeah, like it almost just seems like, to put it simply, it's just a way of invoking the white, possibly the tower, although we're never quite sure if those two things are the same or not, but whatever.
Yeah. But when it touches Henry, it says here, Henry, with whom we began this chain, it visited not by grace or rage. What touches Henry is a kind of informed clarity, and we see in this moment of informed clarity some of, just in my opinion, the best action writing ever, and definitely some of the best writing in this whole damn book. The whole thing with Henry versus Fisherman is just so good. Like the way King and Straub write from the perspective of a blind man fighting, the way we get into Henry's head and just intimately understand every bit of his thought process as he navigates this fight, even though we're not able to see what's actually happening. It's just wonderful. It's just so good.
Yeah. I agree. I think it is maybe one of my favorite like action scenes of from a King novel. I think that's fair to say, actually. Yeah, there's a certain subset of our listeners will be frustrated if I don't mention that it reminds me of the parts of Worm where our protagonist is blind and navigating by extrasensory perception.
Sure. Yeah.
But not. I mean, it kind of reminds me of that, but also not, because that character did have other senses, whereas Henry is entirely using the senses that he has, which are just extremely sharp versions of the ones that everyone has.
Yeah.
And that makes it like feel very tense, and like the writing is playing with what we know and what we don't know and what Henry suspects. And it's just, I don't know. It's just fantastic. It's really, really fun.
Yeah. I mean, I love this in particular, right? A man standing unobserved with an object like garden shears or a heavy pair of scissors in his hands behind a seated victim will, before delivering the blow, take a long second to arch his back and reach up to get a maximum of strength into the downward stroke. As he extends his arms and arches his back, his clothing will shift on his body. Fabric will slide over flesh. One fabric may pull against another. A belt may creak. There will be an intake of breath. An ordinary person would hear few or none of these telltale disturbances, but Henry Layton can be dependent upon to hear them all. It's just wonderful, right? Like the detail of the belt creaking, the fabric moving, the things rubbing on each other, the slow clockwise studio door revolving as he opens the door and steps in, and as the floral musky scent of mycin invades the studio, the detail behind all this, it's just so fucking good.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it so much.
It's definitely funny because when I was younger, I thought that like a good action scene was an action scene that was fast and kinetic. And I've totally changed my mind on that. Like I now believe in my old age that a good action scene is one that just like relishes in the details of the moment and the description and like that's just so much more engaging because it engages your mind, it engages your senses, and it makes you imagine these things. Whereas if it were just like, you know, this happened and this happened and this happened, you're like, okay, cool, got it, I'm bored.
Mm-hmm.
No, I
agree. It's so tense. Like I've read this book before, I know how the scene ends, and I was still glued to the page because I'm like, oh my god, is he gonna get out of it this time? Like, no, he's not, he's gonna get stabbed. But yeah. It just works. It just works.
Yeah, absolutely. I love it.
And we see here at the beginning of this fight that Henry is actually able to get some good hits against the fisherman, right? He's able to both club him on the head and stab him, but unfortunately not enough. And it becomes quickly apparent that Henry has been mortally wounded himself by the shears. One of the details I love is that we don't actually see the moment where Henry is stabbed. You know, like it only comes later when he's like, ow, I'm in pain, and oh, that's a lot of blood. I guess he stabbed me at some point, and I missed that. And it's because King and Straub are so locked in on this point of view that we don't get to see the fisherman's stroke. We only see, quote-unquote, Henry's strikes.
Yeah, I mean, one of the parts about it that was kind of sad to me is it almost feels toward the beginning like Henry's going to come out on top of this.
Yeah, you got him. You got him. It's done. Yeah.
I mean, he stabs him, right? And you're like, oh, shit, yeah. And then only later do you realize, like, somehow, not only did the stab not really matter much, apparently, but Henry got it much worse, actually. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's stabbed in the arm, I think. It's not exactly clear because Henry doesn't know himself, but I think it's an arm wound.
Yeah, well, the thing, you know, in the next bit, we see that, you know, Bernie is like covered in blood. But he seems to be able to just clean himself up and not have to really deal with the injury. Which is kind of funny, actually, because this is just continues the trend of, you know, remember when Jack Sawyer would incur some horrible injury and then like one page later, it would just never be mentioned again.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're right.
These authors just don't give a shit about that. Whatever.
Yeah, so Henry is able to get away, of course, not before the fisherman both rips the skin off his cheek with his teeth and also chops two fingers off his right hand, thus cementing Henry Layton as a gunslinger forever.
Holy shit.
You didn't notice that?
It's a reference.
It is. I don't know if it's his trigger finger or not, but who cares? The point is he lost his rolling fingers.
It's his microphone hand.
Yeah. So Henry goes to hide, and it's in this moment that sadly, tragically, Henry kind of just basically does the math and realizes that he's dead. Like, even if the fisherman doesn't find him, he's losing blood much too fast. And I think this is the line that hurt me the most for whatever reason. Among the things he would now never be able to do, he realizes, is find out what finally happens in Bleak House. Another is seeing his friend Jack again. That's just so sad.
Yeah. I mean, we're going to get that even worse in the next chapter, but just really emphasizing, like, what's actually sad about a person dying, you know? There's a lot. There's a lot of stuff that's sad about a person dying, and we're going to just remind you of all of it.
Yep.
So
Henry then goes on to witness a golem-like conversation between Burnside and Munchen that Peter Jackson obviously just, like, shamefully ripped off of this book, right? Obviously.
Yep. that's what that was.
I mean, to the point where, like, we're described as it as, like, one of them is facing one direction and the other is facing the other direction. Obviously, this was not a thing that Stephen King invented, but I love the detail of it. It's like it is exactly the framing of the Two Towers Golem conversation.
No, you're right. Yeah. I mean, perfectly executed voice acting here from Mueller, by the way. Just a great scene.
So this is something I want to talk to you about, because we haven't really talked about Munchen's weird accent and way of speaking very much so far in the show. And I'm curious how it works in an audio book format, because actually reading Munchen talk is really fucking tough. I basically had to read it multiple times and sometimes just read it out loud to actually understand what the fuck this guy's saying. So I've copied some of what it looks like in text for you here. And I'm curious what your reaction to this is.
I'm very amused, because I honestly just figured that good old Mueller was just reading Munchen's lines with sort of the instruction of, you know, try to do a German accent as if it was described to you, rather than reading, you know, gibberish, which is much harder. Because, like, yeah, like I'm looking at this and I'm like, yeah, if I saw the line, "We have more imprudent work to do," like I would have to read that like three times to understand that he's saying, like, we have more important work to do. But the way that Mueller read it, it was blatantly clear what he was trying to say.
Yeah. You know, I think there are moments that it is certainly beneficial to read over listen. Not many, but there are. I think this is one of those moments where it's incredibly beneficial to be able to listen to this book over reading it. Because, yeah, I definitely, it was not like an easy read where I'm just casually, I had to stop and like reread the stuff Munchen said multiple times.
What's funny is I had no trouble understanding the audiobook, and now I'm looking at this and I'm like, what is H-U-H-H-T? What word is that supposed to be?
What is this sentence here? Read the sentence for me.
Oh, okay. Well, the first part I just remember is foxes down foxholes. Oh, rats in rat holes.
Literally had no idea. Like, yeah, so the way it looks on the page, folks listening at home, is foxes, F-O-G-Z-E-S, down F-O-G-Z-H-U-L-L-S. And I guess if I say that out loud, foxes down foxholes, I could get foxes down foxholes, but, like, Jesus.
Yeah, and then the rest. I don't know, man. It's pretty over the top. I mean,
day to a hut, my boar lost, but it's just, yeah. like I don't know. I appreciate the affect here. I don't know if it's necessary.
Okay, it's the hut means hurt. So he says, he's saying, they too are hurt. My poor lost babies are hurt. Aha. Whatever, man. This is wild.
Verse,
I have no idea.
Verse Danos.
Yeah.
What does that mean?
I had no idea this was like this. And it also makes me wonder, I was going to ask, like, type of, you know, rhetorical question, like, is this a meaningful piece of information? Like, is it just like, oh, he's a demon. He talks weird because he's a demon. Or is it like, he is actually like a, you know, Nazi demon? I don't know, man. Like, does it matter that he has a weird German accent, or is this just flavor?
No, I think dualistically, it's literally just so we can tell the difference between Munchen and Burnside. But I do think a lot of pages have been spent talking about how distinct and weird this accent is, which is another kind of trick because it doesn't actually matter to finding this guy, right? Like there's moments early in the book when you're like, oh, we're gonna, this is a unique, distinct accent, and oh, we've made a character whose superpower is to be able to tell these things, and he's gonna be able to use the superpower to pinpoint an accent that no one else would be able to do. But again, this is the kind of the fake out of this book, is that none of that actually matters at all.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. I think you're right. Yep.
So the fishermen decide to head back to Maxton's to take care of their proprietor before returning to Black House, leaving Henry to die. But Henry isn't going to die yet. Not quite. He has to send a message first, a very important message that definitely will matter. So he summons his strength and crawls back to the studio one last time. And we get this quote, Matt. "The smell of blood is like laughter," Henry says. "Who said that? Somebody. It's in a book. The smell of blood was like laughter." Great line. Now put one foot in front of the other. Now you can guess what Scott Daly spent a good better part of an hour doing the other day.
Googling "the smell of blood is like laughter" quote book uh-huh. quote uh-huh. reference
uh-huh.
and getting exactly two hits, both of which are from this book.
If you are listening and you know exactly what this is a quote from, please email us and let us know. My theory right now is it's not, and Stephen King just thought it was, and just literally somebody, it's in a book, is Stephen King himself being like, it's from something. I've definitely heard this before. It's from something. I don't know. I don't know. It's not. I was so excited about like going down a rabbit hole of what this means and what it could mean thematically. And I've found nothing outside of Black House that this quote exists in.
Yeah, it does remind me that, you know, laughter and slaughter are only one letter off, which weirdly came up last week too. Yeah. But I don't think that's a quote either. So anyway.
Yeah. I just who said that? Somebody. It's in a book.
Whatever. Yeah.
I tried so many different variations. I tried like maybe he's just remembering the quote wrong and it's slightly different. Like if you look at my Google search history, I look like a crazy person.
I like the idea that all of King's characters are as literary as King is without looking anything up.
Yeah. I mean, I but like we'd have no like, God, this is one of those. We need to write this down and be like, if we ever interview Stephen King, be like, hey, sometimes if you give a literary reference but don't say what book is it from, is it because you don't remember? Just be honest. Is it because you don't remember where you heard that? Come on. Yeah.
Do you sometimes just make shit up and say that it's from something?
Yes.
Because it sounds cool?
Totally. And it's so funny because we're going to get an email from a listener that's like, oh, no, this is clearly from blah, blah, blah. And I'm going to be so mad at myself.
It's probably from Bleak House. It's probably... Anyway, yes,
if it's from Bleak House, I'll be real pissed.
Please make fools of us, though. Yes, please let us know.
So Henry managed to get to his studio, and like the fisherman before him, his different voices start conversing with each other, which, I mean, I kind of said that flippantly, but that is what happens here, right? Like that we just witness a scene where two voices of fishermen are talking to each other, and then the many voices of Henry Layton are conversing with each other as he leaves this message for Jack, right?
Yeah. No, it's a great parallel. And we never did get like a resolution, if you will, as to like what are the voices. And it doesn't matter. I don't need a resolution. But I kind of thought we might get some kind of explanation for why he has these spirits or whatever.
I mean, I personally just love it as he has this ability that borders on the magical, where sometimes it just feels magical that he can do this, that he just has this ability to summon these characters and create them whole cloth right here. I kind of love that it just goes unexplained. I think it makes it a little more fascinating and beautiful to me than if we said, oh no, see, the white is tapping into him and blah blah blah, like
I mean the running theory that I had in the back of my mind was that these were ghosts, you know, benevolent ghosts that were kind of riding along with him, but I don't think I actually like that. I just that was one of my guesses. But I you know, as you say, I like the idea that it's just kind of a thing that he can do. It's fine.
So Henry leaves him a message and he says a few things, but one of the things he says is he wanted to stop me from telling you that I recognized his voice and he wants to mess with your feelings. He thinks he can screw you up by killing me. Don't give him that satisfaction. All right. And I think that latter part is the most important thing about this, right? Like, we've already talked about that the actual voices and detecting of the voices doesn't actually matter. But I think that second part is absolutely true. The way to get at Jack is through his grief and sorrow and his inability to handle death. And so, like, that going that route is probably the smartest thing you can do to try to throw him off his game.
Yep, absolutely. And again, the important thing wasn't telling him that it was Charles Burnside's. It was telling him, you know, hey, he's trying to get inside your head, and you're going to need to face some of your demons, you know, more metaphorical demons before you can face the literal demon.
Right, right. And we have a lot to say about Henry's death, I think. And I think we need to get to Jack finding Henry's body before we can really jump into, you know, the thematic why of this. But it's an incredible scene, and another tragic character death that feels on the surface like it was meaningless, right?
Yeah, yeah. Sad.
It is. So we leave this sad scene and we're back with Jack as he exits Nail House Row. He's standing there thinking and suddenly finds himself surrounded by bees, absolutely surrounded by bees. I love this so much. The bees sift ever closer and their low noise pulses in his ears. It sounds like speech or like song. For a moment, all he can see is a tightly woven network of bees moving this way and that. Then the bees settle everywhere on his body, but the oval of his face. They cover his head like a helmet. They blanket his arms, his chest, his back, his legs. Bees land on his shoes and obscure them from view. Despite their number, they are almost weightless. The exposed parts of Jack's body, his hands and neck, feel as though wrapped in cashmere. A dense feather-light bee suit shimmers black and gold all over Jack Sawyer. He raises his arms and the bees move with him. So this is why I've been setting up the whole bee thing all podcast, Matt. This is what we were going to.
It's great. I mean,
what's going on well, here, Matt?
I mean, I part of me just wants to blurt out, you know, his mom's giving him a hug because the bees have been identified with his mom, Queen of the Bees. Both, you know, with that moniker and like explicitly when she's like chasing the bee around, like really kind of hammered in the bee connection.
Yeah.
And, you know, so, you know, and then the bees, what they actually do for him here is they give him this kind of like emotional psychic support and soothing, you know, mental balm for the ordeal that he's about to face. And, you know, it's the white, it's his mom, it's all of that, just, you know, being bees for a minute.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're spot on there. I really do. I think and what I love about it is he doesn't realize he's been given this bomb because he doesn't understand the full tragedy of what he's about to experience. But it still helps him anyway.
Yeah, right. And I don't know how literal I'm being when I say that. It's his mom. Like, is it actually his, like, is this the ghost of his mom? Or like, I don't know. I mean, I guess we'll see what direction things go with when it comes to his mom and how explicit things get with regard to him thinking about his mom as we go forward.
Yeah. Yeah. So on his drive back, on his drive to visit wonderful Henry, the greatest person he knows, the person that we know is lying there dead, he starts to think about Henry. And I love all of this, this part in particular. The question was, how did a man blind from birth evolve such a specific taste in clothing? Oh, Jack realizes, it was his mother. Of course, he got his taste from his mother. For some reason, this recognition threatens to bring tears to Jack's eyes. I get too emotional when I get this tired, he says to himself. Yeah, that's why, Jack. That's what it is. Uh-huh. It's just that you're really sleepy. There's nothing to do with your mom and the fact that you haven't dealt with your mom's death at all.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. And, you know, I think I'm getting more and more sure of my theory that, like, the reason why he rejected the territories is because his mom died. Basically.
Okay, let's talk about this, because I do think this is something that you said to me in a chat that we've never actually talked about on the show.
Maybe that's true. Yeah. Well, regardless of wherever I said it, my feeling is the big mystery is, why did Jack forget about the territories? Mm-hmm. And so strongly, not only forget, but then when he saw the body of Speedy Parker on a pier or whatever, he like quit his job and ran away. Like why the extreme reaction? And my theory was, ultimately, he did all of that shit and his mom died anyway, just a few years later.
Yeah.
And he felt so betrayed and let down and desolated that he just rejected everything having to do with that whole adventure. And that's, you know, I don't know if we're going to get like confirmation that was, you know, the reason, but like, it makes sense to me. So.
Yeah. I love it. I love it so much. I don't want to say definitively whether or not that there's anything in the next few chapters that confirm or deny that. That's a conversation we can have in a couple of weeks, but no, I think that's great. And I really like it.
Okay, cool. Cool.
So this is just mean. This is mean what happens now. Like, just the way Jack is just like, oh my God, Henry's incredible. It's just mean. It's twisting the knife, right? Like, Henry will rejoice with him, and Jack cannot wait to see how he does it. Henry's rejoicing will be unlike anyone else's. Henry will impart some delicate, cool, good-hearted topspin to the expression of his delight, thereby increasing Jack's own delight. What an incredible, literally incredible friend. If you were to describe Henry to someone who had never met him, he would sound unbelievable. Jack thinks, I must not be so bad if I have a friend like that. And he thinks, I really adore Henry. And you're like, why, Stephen, are you doing this to us? And why are you doing this to Jack? It's just mean, man.
It's twisting the knife. And it makes it really, really sad. I mean, like I said a minute ago, there's a lot of reasons why it's sad when a person dies, and the book is almost in like going through, and it's like, yeah, it's sad because you lose a person who you care about, who you think is cool, who you admire, and just by spending time with them, they make your life better and they bring out the good parts of who you are and they make you happier.
Yeah.
And all of these things, you lose all of them and more. Like it goes on in this vein, right? Mm-hmm. And it's just like, fuck, it's heavy. Yeah.
But you're right that the bees were here for him. And even before he knows Henry is gone, he thinks about the bees and says, in the next second, he remembers the swarm of golden bees that descended upon him. It was against this that they comforted him. Exactly this, he tells himself, the blessing of blessings that vanish. What you love, you must love all the harder because someday it will be gone. It felt true, but it did not feel like all of the truth. The bees said, save Tyler Marshall. The bees said, love Henry Layton. The bees said, love Sophie. So he doesn't realize it yet, but he's getting the message, but he's being girded for the truth of that message, which is that one of those people is already gone. And he doesn't know it yet.
I like that. It's like putting him in the right mindset for what's about to happen so that it doesn't destroy him. Yeah.
But I mean, the unspoken thing here is the bees said, love your mother, but don't like allow yourself to feel sad and allow yourself to love her even if she's gone. You know, I think that's the unsaid bit here.
I'm going to have to quote WandaVision.
Oh gosh.
I mean, what is grief but love persevering? Is the vibe that you basically just said that. That's
so with this bee strength, he enters the house of his friend and finds him dead. And I love like the way the text does this, Matt. The second he smells the blood, he knows, right? He hasn't even seen Henry's corpse yet, but at the second he smells the blood, it's Henry is dead and the fisherman killed him. It is his job now to find the body. He's a Capice man. He has to act like one. And I think like there's a moment here where he almost falls back into the same pattern, I think, of, you know, like Henry's dead. I have to be a cop and find the body. That's my job here. But there's a moment here with the sorrow, right? Because it says sorrow comes in many forms, but the kind of sorrow that has been building within Jack Sawyer feels it as if it is made of granite. But the text goes on to say that this is important sorrow, right? That it matters, and the sorrow is not to be deterred or deflected. It works like steel in his spine. The ghost of Henry Shake whispers, "Jack, this sorrow is never going to leave you. Are you down with that?" And the answer to that question is yes. And this is, I think, Matt, when we get to the point of why was this death necessary? Why was Henry's sacrifice here necessary? Why does any of this matter? And it matters because Jack needs to be taught another lesson, right? He needs to be taught that sorrow is okay, that it doesn't always go away, but it can be a form of strength for you, and you shouldn't run from it. And he's not running from it here.
Yeah. The phrasing of that sentence you just read is incredibly interesting, because mm-hmm. I'm just going to pick out part of the sentence. He waits for the stony sorrow to help him deal with his grief. How, mm-hmm. I've never thought of sorrow as being something that helps you deal with your grief.
Yeah.
I almost think of grief and sorrow as being synonyms, but it's like, no, the emotional pain, the sorrow is not identical to the loss. Like, and I don't think I have the, I don't think I necessarily even understand exactly the distinction that King is going for, but I feel the distinction that he's going for, if that makes any sense.
Like, yeah.
I get what he's going for, even if I have a hard time articulating it. And I think that's really cool. And it's like, yeah, like you can be, because Jack has clearly been suffering from grief this whole time, this whole book.
Yep.
But he hasn't allowed himself to feel the sorrow.
Yeah, he's deterred and deflected it, right?
Yeah, yep. And by fully feeling that sorrow, that will actually help him deal with his grief. And as the text says, he'll need that. He needs the sorrow as almost a weapon against the further challenges that he's going to face.
Yeah, it will help him deal with Black House too, right? And I think that's like the cost of not running away from this sorrow is that it never leaves you, right? That's what Henry Shake was. This will never go away. Are you down with that? And I think he has gotten to the point where he recognizes how incredible of a person Henry Layton was, how much he loves him, how much he adores him, it says, that's a price he's willing to pay. He says, yes, I accept that. I accept that this will be with me for the rest of my life, because it will. Absolutely. When you lose the people you love in your life, especially, you know, your mother, for example, that's not going to go away. I mean, your grief will abate over time, right? Like that eventually dulls, but you're never not going to feel sorrow at the loss of a loved one. Like, you're just mm-hmm. not going to. And that doesn't, and his solution to that was to run from it. And I think, you know, this is reinforcing the opinion you just made of why did he forget the territories? Because he ran from that grief. He ran from that sorrow. He did this thing. He saved his mother, and then she died anyway. And he said, fuck the shit. I don't want to deal with it. And I'm going to run away from it. And this entire book seems to be a lesson in, you can't do that, man. You can't do that. You're not going to be happy. You're not going to be fulfilled. And you're most importantly not going to be doing the things you're supposed to be doing. Mm-hmm. You are special, Jack. You are supposed to be doing special things. And you cannot do those special things if you keep running from the way you feel.
Yep. Love it.
So Jack calls the police station, passes on Henry's warning, and then walks into a field to sleep. And as we see, flip over into the territories in his sleep.
Which, you know, okay, we see that he called the police station, but it's like even more pointlessness because it doesn't stop anything from happening, as we'll see in the next chapter.
It doesn't. No, it doesn't. I like this as an idea of, not necessarily punishment of Jack, because it would be like incredibly cruel to punish for all these people to die as just a punishment for Jack. But I also see that as something the White would totally do, because Ka sucks. But this idea that like these things happened because Jack was too late in realizing the consequences of his actions for this particular thing, but not too late for the fate of the universe, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I it doesn't feel like punishment, but I at the same time, I feel like he did make mistakes, you mm-hmm. know, and I so maybe so, yeah.
So we move on to our final chapter of the week, chapter 25. And after the emotional end to the last chapter, this one begins like this. Oh, forget about that. We know where Jack Sawyer went when he disappeared from the edge of the cornfield, and we know why he is likely to who he is likely to meet when he gets there. Enough of that stuff. We want fun. We want excitement. Lucky for us, that old charming party Charles Burnside, who can always be depended upon to slip a whoopee cushion under a governor's seat during a banquet, to pour a little hot sauce in the stew, to fart at the prayer meeting, is at this moment emerging from a toilet bowl and into a stall in the men's room on Daisy Wing. So I might be reading a little bit too much into here, but I felt when I read that section a little bit of resentment coming from our authors at us, the reader. You know, this idea of enough of that. We want fun. We want excitement. Just seems a bit barbed to me, as if saying, this is the shit you want. I had to kill Henry Layton because this is what you want. You don't want the emotional thematic stuff. You want the death. You want this guy roaming around this hospital, chopping fingers off and stabbing people in the throats with these hedge clippers. And I don't know. Am I completely off base here?
I think there's something there. I mean, so this dovetails with something I've been thinking about recently, especially basically ever since reading Hearts in Atlantis. Because I think I'm going to speak about Stephen King specifically here because I don't know Straub that well, mm-hmm. But I think that Stephen King is always sort of trying to write something as impactful as Lord of the Flies was to the young Stephen King. But he's also simultaneously working within the confines and the expectations and the limitations of genre fiction. So he wants to make us feel strong emotions and have meaningful experiences while reading. But he also wants to entertain the shit out of us. And he knows that he can only sell us books if he entertains the shit out of us also. So I do think that there's a sort of friction between like prurient spectacular horror of a madman chopping off fingers and you're actually kind of enjoying it versus like actually horrible horror that you wish didn't happen and you wish you hadn't read it and you don't want to think about it. And it's like he's always trying to slip in the latter mm-hmm. while entertaining you with the former. I don't know if I spoke to your actual point, but I do feel this underlying tension that I think you're gesturing at.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right there. And part of me wonders, you know, if you asked Stephen King as he's crafting this wonderful character of Henry Layton, if he planned to kill him at the beginning or if like that is just the way the story went and he's kind of pissed off about it. You know, this is the way the story needed to go and I'm not really happy about it. And so I move away from Henry's death to this other scene. And I'm like, you fucking animals, all you want is for me to make these great stories where I kill all these beloved characters. And I'm pissed off about it. And I'm working out some of my frustrations here in the opening words of this chapter.
Yeah, I've never been able to get a straight answer from any authors that I know about how they actually feel about killing characters. Because they hurt, because you as the reader think that it must hurt them. But maybe they fucking love it.
Yeah, I mean, I think some do. Like, it's so interesting because, like, I don't know. Sometimes I think that when you're an author, you know, crafting a character, you're like seeing the backside of Walt Disney World, where like the magic of them as a person is lost because uh-huh. you're so busy in the intricate details of how to construct them.
I love that metaphor. Yeah.
So I don't know. I think there's probably some writers who are very, very closely connected to their characters and it hurts them to kill them. And there are some writers that have very clearly delineated them as a tool to tell this great story I'm telling. And this is what I need the tool to do next. I need the tool to get set on fire. Uh-huh. So I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. So I don't know.
That's a good point. I know George R. R. Martin has said that writing the Red Wedding scene was like a harrowing experience for him. So that's mm-hmm. that's one data point.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. There's an interesting scene here, and I'm trying to figure out how to frame this because we see Bernie come back through Maxton's through his bathroom stall porter, and he checks himself out in the mirror, and we see this. Bernie's only mistake is that while buttoning up his damp shirt, he looks at himself in the mirror. What he sees stops him cold with shock. Despite his ugliness, Charles Burnside has always approved of the image returned to him by mirrors In his opinion, he looks like a guy who knows where to find the corners, sly, unpredictable, and foxy. The man staring at him from the other side of the mirror is nothing like the canny old operator Bernie remembered. The men facing him looks dim-witted, worn out, and seriously ill. Sunken, red-rimmed eyes, cheeks like craters, veins crawling across his bald, skull-like crown. Even his nose looks bonier and more twisted than it had once. He is the sort of man who frightens children. And the delicious irony of him being upset about being a person who frightens children when he murders and eats them is wonderful. But I mean, I don't know. I'm really fascinated by this choice to define Charles Burnside's like this. And I'm curious what your takeaway from this was.
Well, I actually got a strong impression that like this was one of the hints that Munchen is just using Burnside for his own needs. Mm-hmm. And using him up, actually, and maybe even plans to discard him soon, or you know, as soon as is convenient, anyway. Whereas Burnside thinks they're partners, he thinks they're buds, inseparable, and I think there's hints here and there that he's super deluded about that, and this is one of those hints, I think.
Yes, I think you're spot on there. I think. You know, this combined with Bernie learning that his quote unquote aunt has stopped funds for his stay at Maxton's, all these things combine to kind of start to give the hint that Munchen is just about done with Charles Burnside. And I mean, we've already seen that he moves on to a different people. Like he was with the original fisherman and then he used him up and spit him out. And this is newest one. And I think to take the pin out that we put in, I do think this is part of the reason why Bernie has such a negative response to hearing Henry like imitate his voice, that he's in this space right now where he's actually, concerned maybe subconsciously about the fact that he's losing control of his situation. And so seeing someone else like puppet him and operate him in a certain way triggers that kind of concern, and is so it's more impactful to him than it normally would have been. That's my opinion, at least.
Yeah. That's where I thought you were gonna go with that, and I agree.
So on his way to murder Maxton, Bernie deals with the annoying nurse who keeps asking him annoying questions like, why is there blood on your shoes? I think the murders here are really interesting because they're so violent. Very specifically full on graphic violence, like Burnside yanks the clippers out of his belt, grips the handles and clips off her fingers as easy if they were twigs. He opens the clippers and rams one of the blades into her throat. Georgette makes a choking, gargling sound. She tries to get her hands on the clippers, but he pulls them from her neck and raises them to her head. Her hands flutter, scattering blood. This is very, very graphically violent in a way that, you know, I don't know if we see that too often.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? In this multi-year project studying Stephen King, how little of this kind of thing there actually has been. I got to be honest. When I, you know, as the neophyte, when I heard The Master of Horror, I sort of expected there'd be a lot more, you know, cover to cover graphic, shocking violence. But there has not been, and in fact, this scene and the subsequent one is unusually graphic. Mm-hmm. In fact, it almost makes me think this isn't Stephen King because it's so unusual. You're totally
possible.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. He definitely does do it but it is rare, especially amongst the books we've covered and it's so, you know, the thing that really drew out to me is how distinct it is from the Henry Layton violence scene, you know, because Henry doesn't get to see these things happening to him. And so, and I think it reinforces his superpowers, right? Because the casual nature with which Burnside just ends these people before they have any opportunity to do anything versus Henry, the blind guy, manages to put up a fight.
Yeah.
It really makes him even more distinct, I think.
Yeah. And I like you pointing out just the contrast between the two scenes, because it's like this one almost relishes the violence.
Yeah, because we're in Burnside's head.
And also it goes along with the way the chapter began, where it's like, we don't want to talk about all that sad stuff. Mm-hmm. Let's have some of the fun and horrible violence.
Yeah.
Which certainly delivers that.
Totally. Totally. So Bernie carries on to Maxton, who has gotten a call from a state detective and figured out that Charles is in fact Carl Bierston. So he knows the thing that seemingly everyone knows now, but we know doesn't matter. And he decides he can use this knowledge to his advantage, especially since he has just gotten the notice from Bernie's aunt that no more money would be coming in for his care. And this is what we'd already talked about, that we learned that the money was actually arranged by Mr. Munchen. And the fact that he's trying to deciding to turn that spigot off is pretty telling here.
Right. Yeah. Munchen, or, you know, I guess via like the Crimson King's network of cheapskate bureaucrats.
Yeah. Yeah. Something I really love in this moment the description of Black House, because we haven't seen inside Black House yet. And the more we learn about it, the less of a house it seems, right? Like I love this here. Mr. Munchen helped Bernie to see the possibilities of Black House, and he contributed many and many a touch of his own device. There are regions of Black House Charles Burnside has never truly understood, and that frightened him badly. An underground wing seems to contain his secret career in Chicago, and when he drew near that part of the house, he could hear pleading whimpers and pungent screams of 100 doomed boys, as well as his own rasps of command, his grunts of ecstasy. For some reason, the proximity of his earlier triumphs made him feel small and hunted, an outcast instead of a lord. Mr. Munchen has helped him remember the scale of his achievement, but Mr. Munchen has been of no use with another region of Black House, a small one, at best a room, more accurately a vault, which houses the whole of his childhood and which he has never, ever visited. The merest hint of that room causes Bernie to feel like an infant left outside to freeze to death. So all this is contained within this house, apparently, and it's really some really interesting character work on Charles Burnside here near the end of the book, too.
Yeah, it makes him seem, pathetic and frightened, fundamentally frightened. I mean, we talked before many times about how often King villains are fundamentally scared. And this seems, by rooting him in a childhood of abandonment and fear, it's like, you certainly, I frankly don't feel any pity for this character, but I do feel like, there is some humanity to him, actually.
And we've talked about this so many times, how, you know, the Fisherman combination almost represents the two sides of how Stephen King views evil, right? We have the actual great demon, Mr. Munchen, who is just a literal embodiment of evil. And then we have Charles Burnside, who is a guy. He's just a guy, and he's horrible. He's a monster, but he's a monster that is humanized and then manipulated by this great evil to do even greater evil.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. I mean, this kind of stuff makes me feel like Bernie is basically not Munchen's partner at all, but just another of Munchen's victims in a sense.
Yeah. Yeah. So Charles manages to kill poor Maxton and escapes just as the police are arriving. Like you said, the warning from Henry did nothing in the end. Everyone that was going to die is still dead.
Yep.
So we cut back over to Jack as the chapter heads towards its conclusion. Jack is dreaming again. And here we've already talked about this a lot, but just to reiterate it, in that dream, everyone went on a journey and no one went anywhere else. And a traveling boy captured a most marvelous prize. And Lily Cavanaugh Sawyer captured a bumblebee in a glass. Smiling, she carried it to the swinging doors and launched it into the upper air. So the bumblebee traveled far away to far away as it journeyed worlds upon worlds on their mysterious courses, trembled and swayed. And Jack, too, journeyed on his own mysterious course into the infinite robin eggs blue. And in the bee's accurate wake, returned to the territories where he lay sleeping in a silent field. So this kind of, I think, serves to kind of bring everything we've been talking about together, right? It once again connects Lily Sawyer with the bees, in case the readers hadn't fully made that connection yet. And it allows him, I think, to recognize, you know, like in this moment, he's not sad about the loss of his mom, right? He's cherishing her memory in a way that it isn't barbed with that grief anymore, I think.
Yeah. And it seems like he hasn't been able to do that in a while.
Yeah. We also see here, Matt, that Jack bangs Sophie in the territories. She heads up to him while he's sleeping and they get it on. And the text is nice enough to take us away from that before we see. I love when the text is like, and what they do here is really none of our business. Yes. And then he kind of winks at you and he's like, but I think you know what's going on there.
Yeah, we all know. We all know what happened in that field. It's great. Yeah.
So Jack heads back to his house after the bang session, and it's early in the morning, so he goes back to sleep again, and he dreams again. This time he dreams of Black House and all the horrible things in there, and it's like, to make this metaphor even more complete, Matt, the Black House is, we're told, kind of representative of all the horrible things that have happened to him in his life. Every horrible person, everyone we've seen, every villain and monster we've seen from the Talisman and from Black House are represented in this house, right? And I think that that aligns with what we just saw from Bernie, right? That this house represents the pain and misery and terrible cruelty that has been visited upon you and you have visited. So, you know, he has this wonderful dream of this wonderful adventure, and then has a terrible dream of this thing he hasn't quite faced yet. Like, very clearly saying, okay, good, you've learned the purpose of sorrow. You've learned how this thing can help you. But you're not done yet, kid.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you're ready to face the final trial. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So Jack wakes up, calls Dale, and tells him everything. He finally is communicating with people, tells Dale everything, and we end the chapter with Dale and Jack approaching Beezer and to go to the Black House. And so that's where we end.
All right. Time for the final showdown.
Yeah, our quartet is formed now. It doesn't look like we thought it was going to look. We thought Henry was going to be there. We thought some more members of the Thunder Five were going to be there, but they formed up anyway.
Yeah, yeah. Can't wait to see what happens. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, and that is going to be next week, Matt, because we are going to finish the book next week. We have moved on to part four, which is titled Black House and Beyond, and that will take us to the very end of the book. So we won't have long to wait.
Yeah, excited.
Yeah. All right, let's move on to our discussion question session. Matt, this episode is going very long, so let's move through these very quickly, as quickly as possible.
Yeah, sounds good. So first from Mega Muffin. Oh, yeah, sorry.
Well, let's say what the question
was. The question from last week was your favorite sick time viewing comfort show. In honor of Scott having COVID last week and me being sick this week, it's just a fantastic coincidence. MegaMuffin 102 says, yes, comfort shows. I love having something on the background I've seen so many times that I don't have to pay attention unless I want to. Some of my favorites are The Office. During the first 6 months of the pandemic, I was laid off work. I watched this through fully three times. It's mindless, easy humor. Superstore, another lockdown binge. I hadn't seen it before, and it definitely deserves more recognition than it gets. Again,
Matt, do you remember our friend from college, Eric?
Yes.
His sister was one of the head writers on that show, Superstore.
Ah, cool.
Yeah.
That's fun. I've never seen Superstore, but that's cool. Fun, easy humor you don't have to think too much about. The Great British Baking Show. When I'm stressed out over something, the show is so relaxing. The contestants are all so sweet and helpful to each other. It's adorably funny, and you get to see all kinds of desserts. Yum. Oh, that's interesting. A cooking show where people aren't horrible.
It's because it's British. Okay. It's the American cooking shows where everyone's fucking terrible to each other.
And then finally, Dairy Girls. If you haven't watched it, I can't recommend it enough. It's brutally fucking funny. So
Dairy Girls rules, Matt. Rules.
Okay. So Mega Muffin likes things that are funny, it seems.
Baby, Can You Dig Your Sam says, well, after 2.5 years of avoiding COVID and all its variants, of course, I develop a high fever on an airplane to Laguna Beach, California on my first vacation in 3 years and test positive. 2 days in, I developed the absolute worst sore throat of my adult life, like shards of glass were embedded in my throat. With nothing else to do but watch Prime on our Airbnb, I chose the first thing that popped up, CBS's Evil, and binge watched all of season one. Crime show procedurals are comfort food for the ailing, and this one did not disappoint. Lots of strange shit, skeptics serving up dishes of course there's a logical explanation, and there mostly was a cuckoo VR weird little girl, and Lost's Ben Linus in a role cementing his evilness for all eternity. When in the penultimate episode he's in therapy with a cloven-hooved uber baddie, it's just deliciously surreal and ridiculous. Thankfully, I started feeling better and started venturing out to enjoy the remnants of vacation, but I'm looking forward to season two once I get back in the swing of things. I think I binged Evil when I was sick last year at some point, the first season as well. So we have something in common there. This show actually reminded me of Stephen King a lot in some ways. It is definitely a crime procedural, but also there's demons, and I think it's a lot of fun.
Cool. I never heard of it. A lot of people binging shows I've never heard of, weirdly enough. Mm-hmm.
Also, I want to say, just overall on these answers, a lot of people getting COVID right now, Matt. I mean, I like understand statistically, yes, but like the number of people saying, yep, I got COVID a couple weeks ago too. I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah. Just for the record, what I have right now does not appear to be COVID.
That's good.
It would have been really funny though if you and I got COVID at like the same time, despite not having seen each other in like 2 years or something.
Yes.
Pedro Achilles says, I don't have many comfort shows or books for when I'm under the weather, because when I get sick, I get sick. And the last thing I want to do is read or watch TV. Once, about 13 or 14 years ago, I was homesick from work and I wound up reading Cormac McCarthy's The Road in one sitting. Do not do this. I agree. Do not do this.
Do not.
Oh my God. However, the last time I got really sick was when I had COVID at the end of 2020 and I ended up coming across this podcast, which helped me through the tedium of quarantine. So thanks, guys. I'm glad we could help.
Yeah, no, that's great. I'm so happy that we were able to help you. I think podcasts would be actually a really great sick thing, because you can lay there. Like at TV, you have to kind of be watching, but you can just lay there and listen.
Yeah, you can be in bed. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Pear Jane says, miniseries are definitely my go-to for sick days. They're long enough that if you record on slow speed, you don't have to get up and change the tape that often. I watched the Stand miniseries in the 90s, although I honestly couldn't advise against that as a sick viewing more. Since my first pregnancy, when I finally read Jane Austen, her adaptations are always my comfort viewing. The BBC versions run from 3 to 6 hours, and the gentle English accents, the chamber music, the utter lack of high stakes action, and anything approaching loud noises makes them the ideal sick day viewing. They all end quite contently as well, with lovely satisfaction, knowing the fools are disappointed, and that our heroine grew as a person and marries someone who respects and loves her for who she is. Man, that's great. I only recently read my first Jane Austen book, probably only a few years ago. Everyone kept saying how good Jane Austen is. So I was like, fine, I'll go read Pride and Prejudice. And I did. And it was fucking phenomenal. And I love Jane Austen. And which one did we watch?
We did Matt?
Sense and Sensibility.
Sense and Sensibility.
For the Doofcast. Yeah.
That was fun.
Yeah.
Cool. Good stuff. Interesting point about like wanting something like low stakes and quiet when you're sick.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm the same, but I can totally, I get it. You know,
I'm not the same, because my thing is definitely like Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
And like, like Lord of the Rings and that kind of stuff.
But I do want to watch something I've seen before, which does remove the surprise factor, you know?
Sure.
Yeah. All right, Boner 666420. My go-to favorite go-to-sleep movie is Fire in the Sky, the allegedly true story of Travis Walton's alien abduction experience. The first 95% of the movie is boring as fuck, as it focuses mostly on dudes taking polygraph tests and shouting, "I know what I saw!" ad nauseum, nearly guaranteed to help you nod off. But if you make it to the very end, you'll be treated to one of the most horrific scenes in sci-fi, as Travis has a sudden flashback to waking up on the spacecraft and being subjected to brutal surgery by shark-eyed little alien bastards. Then you don't even need to worry about trying to sleep anymore, because you can't. Star Trek TNG is pretty solid too, I guess. It's not like it's been my comfort blanket through thick and thin for the better part of a decade or anything.
That's a good choice.
Yeah, I wish I could say that I use that as my comfort blanket, but I usually just forget that it exists when I'm feeling sick. But, you know, I'm sick right now. Maybe tomorrow I'll just watch TNG all day.
Hell yeah. Go.
All right.
Matt, similar to our vampire question, do you think aliens abduct people? Do you think that's actually happening?
I think less than 1% chance, but more than one in a million, somewhere in that range.
All right.
Low chance, but not impossible is what I'm
looking
for.
A definitive answer here. And you copped out on me. It's a very lawyery answer.
I mean, I think it's pretty unlikely that it's real, but I'd like to keep an open mind.
Fine. All right. Looms Bachelor says, what a perfect time for this discussion question. I had COVID the first week of the month and found myself going through a deep dive of all the Halloween movies, including all alternative cuts. I was inspired by the excellent With Gourley and Rust podcast, which also factored into the cozy comfort. Something about the bizarre and fascinating takes on the material each subsequent chapter delivers was a perfect lay in bed and stare viewing. A franchise that never should have been one, but here we are, 12 films later and a 13th coming. Plenty of weird choices to dissect without ever being too much for a COVID-addled head. So Looms Bachelor went the opposite of Pear Jane. So,
yeah, I don't think I would want to watch like full-on horror movies with jump scares and so forth.
No, I'm with Looms Bachelor here. That's a great sick time viewing for sure.
Yeah, cool. All right. Hobo Demon says, when you're sick and in need of a comfort show, it can be really easy to fall into a rut of withdrawn introspection and nonverbal malaise. The title that helped me the most to break out of that cycle is Mind Game by Studio 4C. Without giving too much away about the plot, it follows Nishi on his transition from boy to man as he learns to put into practice a couple of very important pieces of the philosophies of Thoreau and Beauvoir, I guess that is. I don't know who that philosopher is. First, he embraces his inner sense of drive and puts his self on display for the world to see so his community can have the gift of knowing him. This goes off the rails. He and his friends jump the shark into the bottom half of the hero's journey in the sacred space, and there he has to break back out of the introversion rut and empower those around him so they can flamboyantly express their genuine selves and be truly known to one another in community.
This is definitely an anime, right? Like 100%.
I think it's an anime, but it sounds very like philosophical. They go on to say this kind of cosmic stuff is their jam. This sounds really cool. Sounds really interesting. Gonna watch another. Yeah, you know, it's funny. I barely watch more anime than you have, but but this sounds interesting though. I actually like it. Sounds heady. I'm gonna look it up.
All right. Emperor Fry the Solid says, Star Trek is always comfort watching for me. Next gen when you need a single dose of moral uprightness and ASMR with that background noise. Deep Space Nine when I need an angry space dad who will protect me from anything. Original series when I need to feel morally superior to everyone on screen. Voyager or Enterprise when I'm feeling cheeky, usually after a fever breaks and my throat feels well enough to groan. And probably some of the actual new stuff, but I'm being 90 years old about paying for separate subscription services. Well, which is totally fair. I don't think I paid for CBS, which is what all the new Star Trek is on, until very recently. And I still haven't watched Discovery because I just can't.
Yeah, I haven't watched a lot of the newer stuff, almost any of it. I sometimes, you know, I want to just get that Enterprise D background hum and just have it playing in every room of my house all the time.
It's real good, man.
It's the good shit.
Yeah.
Playing on a loop. Yeah.
Who needs cold medicine when you have the Enterprise D humming in the background?
Yeah, I'm going to put that on while I sleep tonight.
Tell me if you get the best sleep of your life.
Yeah, I bet I will. Michelle Y says, this one is for Matt. When I'm properly sick, the round the clock, stuck on couch or bed, snuffling, miserable, can't sleep, can't think kind of sick, I watch the extended edition of The Lord of the Rings and all the making of bonus material videos. I find great comfort zoning in and out of consciousness to the next Bigature's short or Kieran Shaw's story of arguing with Viggo Mortensen over fish curry. When I'm only suffering from chronic insomnia, then I turn to anything narrated by Sir David Attenborough. It was really funny. I was like, while we were like literally having the episode like an hour ago, I was thinking about like how much I would love to just like curl up and watch the Fellowship of the Ring.
Matt, we were recording a podcast.
I know. I don't feel good.
Well, let's finish then. The Man in Black 19 says, my comfort viewing is either the Tremors movie or the extended edition of Lord of the Rings. I've seen those so many times that if I fall asleep, I don't have to back up to watch what I missed.
The Tremors,
yeah, that's a key. That's a key.
Why is Tremors such a perfect answer? Yeah, Tremors is... It's
fucking Tremors, man. It's great. Kevin Bacon.
It's great. It's just a great movie. Shortstop 88 says, since I was sick last week and I don't enjoy rereading or rewatching things, which is interesting. That's the opposite of me. I can talk about what I read or watched while I had COVID last week.
See, everybody's getting COVID.
COVID last week. I watched an anime about gambling, but since the name is Japanese, I won't force you guys to pronounce it. If anyone's curious, it's the one that has two seasons available on Netflix.
There's definitely only one of those.
They say it's not a show they'd recommend to us because it portrays the characters in a weird way. But I like things that are weird sometimes.
Matt, stop watching anime.
Okay. They say, I also watched the start of Umbrella Academy Season 3, which was fun. But it came out on the last day of my quarantine, so I didn't watch all of it. I need to watch that because I actually watched Umbrella Academy.
I haven't seen any of the third season yet.
For reading, I read through about a dozen really long chapters of Practical Guide to Evil, which is a web serial. I'm now within throwing distance of the end of this online serial, and there's a lot of exciting moments I got to experience while unable to leave my bed for 2 days. Unfortunately, one of my favorite characters also died during this binge, and so I stopped reading for a while after that due to how sad it made me.
That's fair.
It's an interesting smorgasbord of options.
The thing that I find most interesting about this answer is that I don't revisit content when I'm sick thing, because I think that's the time when I definitely do.
Yeah.
Like I am very busy and my media diet is such that I'm trying to watch as much as possible to where I don't have a lot of time to revisit stuff either. But like when I'm sick, I feel like I can give myself permission to do that. Like I rewatched Jurassic Park while I was sick with COVID, and that movie rules, and I'm so glad I got to watch it again.
Yeah. I mean, another answer for me would be like Star Wars. And it's like, I've seen Star Wars more than any other thing, literally. And that's what I'll watch when I don't feel good. Mm-hmm. So
Queen Becky Book says, I had COVID a little over a year ago, Omicron variant. I watched a couple of mindless traveling shows. Amazing Rentals was my favorite. That's not my comfort media, though. I also played through all of the Bioshock games, including the DLC. Those games are one of my favorite loves. I love the story. The artwork is beautiful, and I played it so many times. The gameplay isn't too tough for my illness brain. Have you played Bioshock, Matt?
A little bit of it. I've not beat it.
You would enjoy those games.
I'm sure I would. Yeah, I've heard good stuff. I kind of know all the memes, unfortunately, but I'd probably still enjoy it.
I wonder how many, like, do you have any illness games? Because I feel like when you're really feeling bad, games are almost too much. But I definitely do play games sometimes when I'm sick.
I can't think of any examples. I mean, maybe God of War, but like only if, like maybe not though, because like it's too intense. I don't think I have any illness games, honestly.
Okay.
I mean, maybe chess, actually. Like on my phone, I'll play chess, but that's hardly what you mean when you ask that question. All right. Complicated 9519 says, why anime, of course, and Jurassic Park. When I'm sick and feeling down, I just enjoy watching anime and Jurassic Park. Usually it's older movies or shows that I have a place in my heart. And if it shows, it's something short. But movies always have to be sad and sappy for some reason. I won't go into detail on what they are, what they're about. Some of my favorites to watch when sad are a Silent Voice, Weathering With You, and Your Name. We watched Your Name for a Doofcast, by the way.
We did, and I liked it, and it's an anime.
Yeah, that's the only one.
The only one.
Ghibli movies are also nice, they say. Jurassic Park, because it's just my favorite movie, of course. At one time when I was depressed, I got Jurassic World Evolution, the Dino Park simulator game, and spent 14 hours straight just playing it one day. That's a totally reasonable thing to do, and I could see myself doing the same thing.
You are doing the same thing right now with your stupid Elden Ring obsession.
Yeah, or at least I was a couple weeks ago, yeah. Yes, they also agree with me that sleepy medicine is the way to go when you're sick.
Yes. No, it's awful. Read what they say. They give me Stephen King tier nightmares. That sounds awful. Why would you subject yourself to that?
No, they don't give me nightmares. The problem is if I do it like two nights in a row, then I become subtly dependent on it. And then the next night sucks. So it's not really worth it.
This is why these things terrify me. And I just don't do it. I just don't do it. I'd rather just be awake.
Yeah. Well, we'll see.
What do you mean we'll see? What are you going to do to me?
I think what I meant by that was now I have to see whether I'm going to take sleepy medicine tonight. Okay. I have to make that choice.
Just Stand 8460 says, at any given time in my life, I prefer to be either laughing or learning or both. However, when I'm sick, I defer to the former, and nothing delivers a fast pace, effortless and endless serving of laughter like binge watching It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. I loop that shit like it's a freaking hula hoop, which means over and over. Unfortunately, I also tend to fight sickness when I should be resting, and I end up taking time off work only to spend it catching up on house projects or cleaning up for my four very active kids. Not sure if you knew this, but self-care is not a myth. I think it is. I don't do any of that stuff.
Self-care is cleaning up after your kids.
I think they're saying stop doing that and actually practice self-care.
I'm not hurtling toward a breakdown or anything. Rear Admiral Bolton. But why did I say that? Rear Admiral Bottom. Rear Admiral Bottom.
Bolton.
I don't know, man. Said, in addition to COVID, this pandemic also exposed me to Gogglebox. It's a British reality show in which regular people watch a certain amount of television every week and talk about the programs with their friends, families, or flatmates. Their viewing time and conversations are recorded and then re-edited for broadcast, especially during the Panini and 2020 election.
Is that what we're calling the pandemic now?
I guess so.
The Panini?
The Panini. Okay. I was just going to blow by that. It has been interesting to see what Ireland, Australia, and the UK thinks of US news and culture. They say they tried a celebrity version in the States, but it didn't really catch on.
I feel like that's really interesting. I've never heard of that before, but part of me says that'd be really fun. And part of me says, oh, most people are really bad at talking about shows and stuff that they like. So that could be really boring too. I don't know.
I'm like, well, this is like the Doofcast, except just like random people, except you and me.
I mean, that's definitely just what the Doofcast is, but
yeah.
We've also been doing it for a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. That sounds fun. I can see why that would be comforting.
Mm-hmm. The Amazing Duck 42 says, my comfort movie series is Tremors. Giant worm monsters will cure many a ill, be it actually sickness or bad moods. The first movie is the best, but the third introduces us to the ass blaster stage of the graboid life cycle, which is an exciting evolutionary development. I've also really liked The Matrix and Constantine as put on and fall asleep movies. I've seen them so many times, the patterns are soothing, which is, I suppose, the definition of comfort.
Yeah.
Yeah. The put to fall asleep movie is key, for sure.
Something about Keanu Reeves, which obviously he's the star of both of those movies, where he's just so chill that he's also, as a human being, he's NyQuil, you know?
Sure, yeah. I love natural NyQuil being Keanu Reeves. Yeah. I'll take that. I'll take that NyQuil.
There you go. Gerardo says, there aren't many shows or movies that I rewatch, and when I'm sick, I usually sleep like a brick. If I were quarantining and conscious and in need of comfort media, I would definitely rewatch The Lord of the Rings and Hobbit trilogies. These are the only movies that I will rewatch again and again. And speaking of, it's about that time again.
It's about that time again for me too, actually.
Yeah, I was just thinking, how long has it been since I watched Fellowship all the way through? Long time.
It's going to be tonight.
Yeah.
Sigma says, I was a morbid child and pretty much remained that way as I grew. To be quite honest, I don't have a lot of cheerful stories around me. They may contain themes of hope, but the actual plots and subject matter are grim. I would play video games when I got sad, but it'd be shit like SMT4, which isn't super comforting. I do put on music on occasion when I get sick, but I don't get sick that often, so I can't name everything. Also, I've only recently started getting into shows and movies, so I'm limited there. I sort of go into a fugue when I'm in the blues. Everything is in a haze. When the second vaccine dose raw dogged me, I put on the It audiobook for some reason. I need cheerier stories, Christ on a bike. But that's a good book. It audiobook would be great sick time listening for sure. Who does the It audiobook too? I think it's
Who does it? Who does it? Quick, Scott, look it up.
It is... why is this taking so long?
I'm doing a really good job vamping.
Steven Weber does it.
Cool.
As seen from the Shining miniseries.
Oh.
That guy.
Oh, okay. Now I get it. Yeah, I bet he did a good job.
Yeah.
Steve L. says, glad you're feeling better and back on track. I get migraines, but rarely get sick, so reading or movies generally aren't helpful with headaches. I haven't gotten into audiobooks much either. They then say, but if I'm sick, I think I would binge watch Lord of the Rings or watch Scrubs, Weeds, or Parenthood, the series, or my all-time favorite show, This Is Us.
Oh, Steve, my friend, the last couple episodes of This Is Us, just, I died. I was weeping.
I don't like to die, and I don't like to weep. I don't like to feel things.
It's the only like basic TV show I watch. It's over now. And I recognize it is like fully going into manipulating you to try to make you cry mode like every single time, but it just works on me. I think the writing's really good and I love the characters. So it's just, I love that show. And the ending was beautiful. And also I cried so much.
Kind of curious, a little bit curious.
It's like seven seasons long. It's a lot of a time investment. I would not recommend you start now. If you fell in love with the show and quit at some point, I would recommend you watch it to the end. But I wouldn't be like, yes, watch the show immediately. You're just going to be sad.
I definitely wouldn't want to watch a show like that when I was sick. Like what my brain just did is I was like, this would be like willingly watching the Futurama episode where Fry's dog dies when you're sick already. It's like, yeah,
that's a good comparison.
Why would I want to feel that way? But but then my brain did another leap and I was like, The Simpsons, on the other hand, is something I would totally watch when I was sick. So
last but not least, we have BC Johnson, who says, I was pretty sick the week before last. It wasn't COVID, but I was out for the count all the same. While bedridden, I watched all three Evil Dead movies and the remake. I guess it was just nice to know things could be worse. Like, I didn't have to saw off my possessed hand or chop up my girlfriend. So, you know, I'm doing all right. For comfort shows in general, Community and 30 Rock are my go-to choices. They're both zany, extremely funny, and I know them well enough that I can zone out or sleep or phone and just feel amused at home without having to pay attention too closely. Plus, they're both bangers. I love Community and I love 30 Rock, so those are great.
It's interesting watching people who are suffering worse than you. So, like, I should try watching The Passion of the Christ.
Yeah, that'd be a great comfort.
And I could movie. Be like, well, at least I'm not that guy.
Did you know they're making a sequel to that movie? And I know what you're thinking. How?
What I was thinking was that this is the setup for a joke, but...
No.
No. Okay. Nope. I didn't know that. How? Yeah,
it's called The Passion of the Christ Resurrection.
Oh. Well, I guess
it comes out in 2024.
It seems obvious now that you say it.
Mel Gibson's directing it again.
Really? Is it going to be... It's going to be... that one actor?
Jim Caviezel. Yeah. Man, he's gone off the deep end.
He's gone off the deep end. And that was like 20 years ago, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was literally 20 years ago.
Oh my God.
But don't worry, Matt. It's the story of what happens in the 3 days between Jesus's crucifixion and his resurrection. Now, I don't know a lot, but I don't think anything much happens in those days. I think it's just a bunch of people being sad. And then, oh, he's back. Yay.
Well, I'm sure they'll... It seems a little sacrilegious. You know? Like, this is the kind of thing that I would get yelled at if I started speculating about when I was a kid, you know?
I'm very fascinated. I don't know if this movie's ever going to actually come out, but... Yeah. It's like having a sequel to the Titanic. You're like, it already...
What?
It happened. It's done.
No? Yeah. Okay. Whatever.
Yeah. Anyway, that is the end. Thank you, everyone, for your answers. I loved all these. I think it's so great. And I think, you know, where I sit, I talked about Jurassic Park. I love watching that movie. I think I'm with people on the 30-minute comedy. The 30-minute comedy is a perfect thing to watch when you're sick, because you can just watch an episode and then fall asleep mid next episode and it doesn't matter. And it's just they move quickly enough where you're always entertained. But yeah, you don't have to pay attention. Like Seinfeld is a great comfort sick watch for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Cool.
All right. That is it. Next week, we will have another question. It will be our final Black House question, Matt, because the week after that, we'll be doing our overview with our mailbag. So this is our last chance to have a Black House related question. And as such, I'm going to ask this question. Who is your favorite character from the Peter Straub and Stephen King partnership that is Talisman and the Black House? All both books. Who's your favorite character in both books and why? And part B, which book do you like better and why?
Yeah.
Which of the two books, which do you like better?
Yeah. Good question. I can't wait to see the answers. I'm sure there'll be a variety. There always is.
Yeah, definitely. All right. That's going to do it for us here this week. As we said earlier in the show, next week we will finish the book. We will be done with our penultimate book of season two next week. How did we get here already? This is absolutely wild.
Yeah. I've seen, kind of snuck up on me, I admit.
Yeah, for sure.
Remember, you can reach us via email at kingslingerspod@gmail.com or on Twitter at kingslingerspod. And of course, the subreddit at r/doofmedia is a great place to hang out and answer the discussion question.
If you aren't already subscribed to the Kingslingers, we strongly recommend you do so. We are finishing up Black House. We are moving on to The Stand, and you don't want to miss it. So sign up right now. You can find us anywhere podcasts are podcasted.
That's right. And if you like any of the shows on the Doof Network and you want to support us, then please consider donating to our Patreon account at patreon.com/doofmedia.
But of course, if you cannot afford to donate, that is absolutely okay. You can help us out by sharing this podcast with all of the Stephen King lovers out there, of which there are so, so many. And of course, you can always leave us a rating and a review on any of the platforms that support those. This week's Spotlight review comes from Hoffpocalypse, who gives us 5 stars and says, wonderful literary analysis. Fantastic spoiler-free analysis that has brought a depth to my first reading through the tower. They are consistently well-prepared and are good at calling out when their own lifestyles and privileges color their commentary. They navigate difficult topic adeptly, balance discussion questions without interrupting each other. Well-mixed, could do without the F-bombs. They always make me cringe, but that's a style choice. Bravo, gentlemen.
It's funny because I feel like both of us have like streaks of swearing constantly and then not swearing much. You notice that?
Yeah, I do. I feel like when we're getting like serious, we do it less.
Yeah.
But also sometimes like to show the amount of seriousness, we do it more. I don't know. It's definitely something I need to work on as my child has ears that understand words now. And I don't want him to say those words, so I need to work on that. So
yes,
thank you for giving us 5 stars even though we say the naughty words.
Yeah, I try only to swear when it's the right thing to do.
You just sometimes you need sentence enhancers, you know.
Yeah. Laboring. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for the review, Hoffpocalypse. We really do appreciate it. And thank you to everyone who continues to send those reviews in. They do help us out, and we really do appreciate them. And finally, we have reached the end of the episode. We will be back next week to finish off Black House. I'm very excited for you to see the ending of this book, Matt. So we'll see you next week. Long days and pleasant nights.
And may you have twice the number.
Now go to bed.
Yes.
But don't take NyQuil. Take DayQuil.
I'm just going to take nothing. I'm just going to drink a bunch of water, actually.